there, shitheads. What's up? You know what? Hannibal and Monty are adding to the ultimate comic book movie list. I am so excited I could just shit myself. Well, you know, I already have. See you soon.
I've never seen anything like it. Ben?
Well, I would say that it was a but the trail's all wrong.
Man, he's fast. Oh, that is cool.
You've been busy, my friend. The are impressive.
The energy was channeled through him, but it originated from his.
If we can separate him from the, we can cut off his power completely.
Reed! Reed!
Oh no! My meat!
Been the giving type, Reed.
Only the Surfer can stop the Destroyer, but he needs his.
Come and get it.
Catch.
We need to find a way to get the.
Victor's got to have a pulse emitter linking him to his. We take it out. We can separate him from his.
Treasure each with her and tell her she was.
Previously on Lost.
I'm training.
Training for what?
You're gonna take his word for it.
His word is all we have, Jack.
Watch the film.
What?
The bookcase. Top shelf, behind ton of the screw. Projectors in the pantry.
Bridge to Captain Picard.
Go ahead.
We've just received word from the fleet. They've engaged the Borg.
Data put Starfleet frequency 1486 on audio.
Aye, sir.
Stan is not a great Eminem song.
No, I did not say Stan is not a great Eminem
okay,
song.
What did you say?
What happens when a masked producer and a headphone-wearing comic book artist get together to talk music shit, comic book shit, and political shit on the internet? Monty. Hannibal the Beat Animal.
Why is my name second? What kind of shit is this?
Hannibal and Monty Shit Show!
Let's talk some shit.
your shit together. Get it all together and put it in a backpack. All your shit. So it's together. And if you gotta take it somewhere, you know? Take it to the shit store and sell it. Or put it in a shit museum. I don't care what you do. You just gotta get it together. Get your shit together.
We're gonna need to watch that again.
You're gonna watch that again.
Aren't you?
No, John, I'm not.
And we are live. Are we live, Monty?
We should be live. I think okay. We're live. I think all we're right, live. Here
we go. Red leather, yellow leather. Red leather, yellow leather. Welcome to the Hannibal and Monty Shit Show. I am Hannibal the Beat Animal.
And I am Monty.
And this is episode 50. Maybe an episode about...
No one laughs at a master of quack foo.
Or.
Who's Hannibal the Cannibal?
There we go.
Yeah, that's not what I thought you were going to do.
I chuckled when I heard that line.
Yeah. Yeah. The minute I heard that line, I was like, second title. Hannibal the second Cannibal. Title. So, yes, we are here. Episode 50. Like, we're not throwing as big of a party as we will on episode 100. Wherever the fuck that falls.
Yeah.
You want to be here for episode 100. It's going to be big. But we're going to make this a torture episode and have fun. We'll discuss the torture episode later. In the meantime, let's talk about the guests we have. We have returning for the second week in a fucking row, Ace motherfucking Wonder. How are you, sir?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm good, man.
Ah, throwback. I like it. Inside jokes, this bitch.
Yes. And we wanted 50 to be a little special, so we have brand new, first time ever on the shit show, Crimson 60602 or 20. Did I get your numbers wrong? Did I fuck that up?
it's from Alsa.
Yeah, 60620, not 02.
Yeah, I fucked that up. Invert the last numbers. Monty fucked that up.
So good morning.
Yes.
And in case I don't see you, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
Yes. Right. There we go. So welcome. First time on the shit show. Like, glad to have you here. And for a torture episode, why did you agree to this shit?
Well, I like talking about nerd shit. I like talking about characters, but I really reconsidered when I saw Ang Lee's Hulk.
We're going to get into that shit in a bit. But before we get there, I want to say we just had an awesome pre-show where we got everybody in, and Crimson chimed in when he got in, like at the scheduled time. He wasn't late. He wasn't on CP time, even though we are. But he got there on time. We had trouble setting it up, which is why we do pre-shows. But we did some awesome shit. If you want to be part of that shit when it's happening, wondering why the fuck the show is late, join us on Patreon, patreon.com/5h1t. Those people got to see why we were so late, because we were trying to figure shit out. And also, if you like the shit while the show's going, streamlabs.com/Hannibal and Monty Show. We're also streaming on Twitch. I don't see any of these other chats yet, so bear with me. Mm-hmm. On Twitch, we are twitch.tv/5h1t show. Facebook.com/Hannibal and Monty. Instagram at 5h1t show, which is the same as the Twitter. Snapchat at show_5h1t. The Discord link is in the description, and if you like the show so much that you want to send us shit, look at our Amazon wish list, which is in the description. Send us stuff up from there. That'll help us make the show better. Or if you have something that's not on that list that you're like, Hannibal and Monty will love this, or Hannibal or Monty will love this, send it to P.O. Box 13013, New Orleans, Louisiana, 70185. There we go. That's all of it.
That's it. That's all of the
That's all. Not that we've had the word from our sponsors.
Exactly.
It's
exactly.
Us. We sponsor ourselves. It's all us.
Yeah, I like to get that shit out of the way right away.
I gotta give Bobbin a plunger point because he says, by the law of nature, a stream with four black people turns legally into a stream with one white guy if you cancel each other out.
We don't have a white guy. What are you talking about?
No, he's saying that because it's four of us, we automatically cancel each other out and become one white guy.
Oh, there we go. Is that how it works? All right. I don't know. I thought eight of us.
I thought it was... History.
Three fifths. All right. Yeah. That's three fifths.
I'm gonna go check my credit right now and see if that tracks. So.
Yes, and also you'll notice your plunger points were not updated. Normally, when people say you'll notice, is because something good happened. I say you'll notice because something shitty happened. Your plunger points were not updated because we didn't get that shit yet. But plunger points for the last few episodes will be updated in the next few days, right, Zoe? Yes. Zoe says yes. Okay. Zoe's been away. She's been riding roller coasters, not doing the shit show.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, she was having fun. I give her a pass.
Yeah, she's got to have fun because school is getting ready to start up again, ain't it?
This is her last shit show before school starts back. So.
Yeah.
She'll be here for the whole shit show, right? And this will be the last shit show until school starts, or before school starts, that she'll be here for the whole shit show. So next shows from here on out will hit a point where she's like, fuck you, daddy. I got to go to bed. I got school tomorrow. So, and she'll say that to me. She'll look at me and she'll go, hey, fuck off, daddy. I got to go to school. That's
right. Dad. You got your daughter sounding like fucking Tyler Perry movie. Fuck off, daddy. I'm going to go to school tomorrow.
Shit, I wish I can get my 12-year-old to help me with a PA, pre-PA assistance. My shit is half-assed, show, so.
There we go. EM Dubois says I'm clipping. I'm going to put my mic a little further away. Y'all let me know if I keep clipping. I think I might be too close to the mic. So, in my gain, I'm going to adjust my gain. Let's see. Let us know if there's audio issues. It's a shit show. but yeah. Yeah. So I'm going to get a little further away. I have a new setup, so I don't know how close or far away I need to be from the mic. So keep me in the loop on that shit. And hang on. Let me adjust this because there we go. Now we got it right. Much better. All right. So.
Yeah. Also, Bob Newman also just donated $2 to the cause. He says, no disrespect, but Ace Wonder, you look pissed. He doesn't look pissed. He looks tired. He just got off of work. So you might be pissed. Shit, I don't know. Yeah. Or maybe he's pissed because Michael Thomas just got that big-ass contract.
I'm all the way with that. Matter of fact, I'm in a wonderful mood, man.
Okay. That's just, like, Bob, that's so you know, this is just how black guys look when we happy.
Yeah,
it, you know.
Yeah, and also, so y'all know, I just saw it pop up on the screen. If this is the only issue with this shit show, I know about it before you put it in the comments. Your text-to-speech will not work because we didn't hear the nickel chat sound. So y'all weren't graced with the soothing sounds of Chad Kroger just now from that nickel chat, but... I'll fix it before the next show. Yeah. So that's the only problem on the 50th. I'm fine with it.
Yeah, we can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll just have to watch.
Yeah. And, you know, shout out to everybody that says Zoe is an angel because she is. Zoe is awesome.
She is. She is.
She don't talk. Like, she don't say nothing. But, I mean, she's a quiet angel, you know. Just like God or Jesus intended. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, your deity of choice.
Yeah, yeah. He says, yeah. So there you go. Anyway, so tonight's torture episode, Monty and I, joined by Ace Wonder and Crimson 60620, will be reviewing a bunch of shitty comic book movies because you guys voted on it because you hate us. And that's fine. We just did a good Spider-Man episode last week, and now this week we gotta follow it up with like bad comic book movies. And
you guys voted on us watching not one, not two, but three different Fantastic Four movies. Y'all should have just went and voted for all four, so that way you could have just forced us to just knock them all out. We got three Fantastic Four movies and Ang Lee's Hulk and fucking a couple other ones. We're going to get to all of those shits in the show. And
but because they picked Rise of the Silver Surfer, you got the shit you saw at the beginning of the stream, which was an idea I've had for years. And it was my first time seeing that movie, and I'm like, you know what? While I watch it, I'm going to edit the fucker and do the idea I had. Because without seeing the movie, I knew that that idea was possible.
Yes. This man, Monty has had that idea for years. Like, there's actually somewhere out there, there's footage of me and Monty having a conversation about this idea. Yeah. You know, and I was just like, wait, you want to do what now to this movie? And he fucking did it. Oh, and also, yes, Loken 16 donated $20 to the cause. So thank you very much, Loken. You are awesome. And you will have the appropriate amount of plunger points to represent that, you know?
Yes.
I want to make sure that it gets... Hold on.
I was about to let you know about that because Zoe just sent the word over to me because it's not making noise. So thank you, Loken. Thank you. I'm on it.
I'm going to be checking, you know, pretty diligently to make sure that's what it is. So next week's episode, Monty and I will be doing a regular...
Wait, before we get to next week, let me set it up. This is how we set this shit up. Let's talk about what's coming up next. There we go. Now, Hannibal, what's next?
So next week's episode of Hannibal with Monty Shit Show, we're going to just do a regular episode of the shit show. Monty and I haven't done one in a while, so we haven't had a chance to do Fair File, shit we don't care about. We haven't had a proper What's Eating Hannibal. We haven't done a Check This Shit Out. So we're just going to get back to the basics and just have a regular-ass episode. And it's going to be fun, and we're going to talk about it. And we're planning out some of the episodes for August. I know we're definitely going to do a Sublime episode this month, correct?
Yes. Well, we have next week, we have just a regular old shit show because those are my personal favorites. Like, I love a show where we don't have anything to talk about. And before that, Friday, we're going to, me, Hannibal, and E. Green are going to talk about this YouTube Cypher Volume 2 with Crypt. That Crypt put, because I've seen it already. Hannibal hasn't. I told him not to until the show. So we're going to talk about that. That shit is fucking awesome, in my opinion. The week after that is our Batman show. And,
That Batman episode, Monty and I, the Batman episode, for this particular Batman episode that we're doing in August, we're only going to talk about animated Batman films. Okay, so don't ask us about Dark Knight, Batman Begins, Batman Returns, Batman vs. Superman. We're not doing it. We're only doing animated Batman movies. And we have, right now, we've picked out, I want to say, four movies, and we're going to let you guys pick the last two. Yeah. So go ahead, Mike.
And look, I'm gonna cheat it a bit. You'll see StreamBot telling you how to grade the movies coming up. With that grade command, add which Batman animated movie you want us to watch. Let's do it that way.
Wait, can I make a suggestion?
Of course.
Does the Justice League movies count too?
Glad you asked, because they do not. Monty and I had a very long conversation about it. It wasn't long. It was about 2 minutes. And we decided collectively that when we do the list of Batman movies, we're not doing any of the movies that's Batman and somebody. So we're not doing, so Batman and Harley Quinn is out of the picture. We're not doing any of the Batman versus movies as well. So those would be out the picture. And we're not doing any of the movies that Batman is featured in. Like he's in a couple of the
we're not Young doing Titans.
Yeah, right. We're not doing those. So it has to be specifically, it has to have Batman in the title. You know what I'm saying? And it can't be him and somebody else. It's just Batman. The only exception being Batman versus Robin, because that is a Batman movie. It's just called Batman versus Robin.
See, that's a cheat, because I would cheat. I would try to throw in Best of Both Worlds from the old 90s TV show. I would consider that a movie.
Yep. All right. I'm glad you said that, because we're not including that. I actually have the list of movies right here. You know what I'm saying? So there it is.
And I'll make it easier. Like, we're gonna take what you send, but Friday, when we do the YouTube rap thing, Hannibal's gonna put all those in a hat and we're gonna make polls from it. So but let us know what should come higher up. It'll help us consider things. So yeah,
I have a list that you guys can pick from. So it's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be, you know, and we've already picked a handful of movies out that batch already. So we're definitely gonna talk about Mask of the Phantasm. Gonna talk about.
Let me pause you for a second. The Valagon or Garrett, you know, is in the chat.
Little something something
is in the chat.
Yes.
And wants to be on the Batman animated episode.
You got to look. Listen. You know what I'm saying? You are welcome to be on the show whenever you want.
Yeah, we like little something something. Although little something something, you got some hate in our comment section. I should have screenshotted that shit to send it to you. That shit was hilarious.
On the mail, go when you get a chance. Not now because you're watching the show, but go check out the Melanie Martinez video we uploaded. Somebody has some choice words for you, bro. It is hilarious. It's like,
yes.
And I look, when Monty was reading it to me, I was like, Melanie Martinez, is that you? Are you in the comments just posing as somebody? All right, so
I will be reading some random comments from YouTube later, but we'll get to that in a bit. But yeah. So Hannibal, tell them what we'll definitely be watching again.
Yes, so we will definitely be watching. Let me see, make sure I got this right. We're definitely watching Batman Hush. Because I'm a huge fan of the Hush character. They just made the animated movie, and I haven't seen it yet. We're going to definitely watch Mask of the Phantasm. We're going to definitely be watching Batman, The Dark Knight Returns, Part 1 and 2. We're definitely going to watch Batman versus the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And then we're going to let you guys pick the last two movies that we watch.
Yeah. Yeah. So
suggestion.
Yes.
What's that?
Batman Beyond, Return of the Joker.
That's on the list.
That's on the list.
That's on the list that they can pick from.
Yeah.
And then look, there's a lot of these Batman movies. And look, that also includes the Lego Batman movie. So if you guys really want to fuck with us, which I would ask that you don't do because we're already doing this episode, you guys can do that.
But, Hannibal, if you keep telling people not to give us the bad things, we're going to get to the end of the Ultimate Comic Book Movie list and have nothing but terrible movies to watch. So throw them in.
Also, Scientist Mel just donated $3.99. She says, love for my shit bros.
Thank you, Scientist Mel. You got the audacity to give us almost $4, but not go to $4.
She was like, if you had $4 exactly, then you could go get a 4 for $4 from this restaurant. But I'm giving you $3.99. Because she wants us to work for that little extra. I like it, man.
I like it too. And
I'm with it.
If y'all aren't subscribed to Mel, Scientist Mel, look her up. Mel on everything. She does the voice of Little Shit, and she does the Oraldacity with Doc Savage. And Doc, you owe us a show.
Yes. Yes. Like if you've not seen the Oraldacity, then you are missing out on life because it is a fantastic show. It's like you learn stuff and you're entertained while you're doing it. It is the literal definition of edutainment.
Yeah.
It is the only time I've used that word not sarcastically.
Yeah. And talking about it right now, I feel so much more connected to Mother Earth. I'm just saying. Watch the Oraldacity to get that joke.
And Monty and I were on episode 3. So make sure you tune into it. Look, just real quick.
I'm gonna just do this right now. So the Batman movies you guys have to choose from. Oh, I'm gonna say this super fast. I'm gonna sound like the Micro Machines dude. Let's see: Batman Beyond, Return of the Joker, Batman Unlimited, Mechs versus Mutants, Batman versus Dracula, Batman versus Robin, Batman versus Two-Face, Batman Assault on Arkham, which is essentially a Suicide Squad movie, but we ain't gonna talk about that. Batman Bad Blood, Batman Gotham Knight, Batman Mystery of the Batwoman, Batman Return of the Caped Crusaders, Batman The Killing Joke, Batman Under the Red Hood, Batman Year One, Lego Batman, Lego Batman DC Superheroes Unite, Lego Batman Family Matters, and Son of Batman. There are enough animated Batmans for us to choose from without having to pick any of the Batman Superman movies and any of the And movies.
Yeah.
We got plenty for you guys to choose from, and we'll have you guys vote on two brackets, and then the two winners will be the two movies we add to the list, and then we'll talk about those at the end of the month. And we'll also have the Sublime episode. We don't have the Torture episode for August set yet, so if you guys have any ideas or thoughts that's not mayonnaise related, then throw them out.
Yeah, and also send those ideas and thoughts to. You can send them to 5h1t_show@sweethalloweenandcollardgreens.com or find us on Discord or any of our social media. Just send us a direct message on anywhere where you can find us for torture episode suggestions. And we'll figure out what to do in August. And I will know by the next episode because that stream goal will change. And also with stream goals, all of your stream goal stuff is coming soon. I just got this new studio set up, so I'm ready to do some art. Hopefully tomorrow or Friday, I will be working on that. So that'll be coming. You'll get your live streams, all that shit. But that's coming. That's what's coming up next. So,
yeah,
we got through all of it. So, let's get to the next part of the show where I let you know that, Hannibal, I got two questions for you.
What are the questions you have for me, Monty?
Here's the first question.
What's up, nigga? You want to talk some shit?
Yeah, let's talk some shit, random black dude.
All right. Well,
he looks like the nigga at the barbershop that always argues you with misinformation that's easily Googleable. Like, he's like, man, Alabama won 17 championships, bro. They the best team all time. I said, bro, it's not 17. I can Google it right here. Here it is. I can see the number.
Yeah, that's exactly who that is. Exactly who that is. So
he's the guy that followed me outside the grocery store last night. He's like, bro, you ain't got a dollar you can loan me?
Is that Hey, man, I know this is going to be random, but he looks like the antagonist from, you remember the movie Class Act?
Yeah. Yeah.
Early 90s?
Yes, I do. And the bad guy from Class Act was fucking Teal'c from fucking Stargate. Which I'm a huge fan
Kratos?
Of.
Fucking Kratos?
Is he Kratos? No, that's not
boy,
Kratos.
Boy, yes. Boy. From, really? From yes. He is Teal'c. He plays Kratos in the new God of War game. That's why they got him. Because he's the mother.
Shut up. Yeah, I mean, that makes sense, though. He's got the voice for it. Like, he's definitely got the voice. But yeah, his name is Chris Judge, Christopher Judge or something.
Exactly.
He's also in Dark Knight Rises. He plays Thug Number 3. So there you go.
All right. See
that sounds like I'm trying to be funny, but I swear he is in the movie and he plays some random guy that runs up like on Commissioner Gordon or something, and he lets him go.
All right.
Ian DeWalt, I am a huge Stargate fan. I could all the way just nerd out on fucking Stargate. Stargate's my favorite show all time. It's not the best show all time. It's my favorite show all time.
I've not watched enough Stargate. Wait. What were you going to say?
I liked it better when it was on Showtime because they had some interesting motherfucking shit. Yeah. Now, when they moved to Sci-Fi, it was a little bit watered down, but like they like literally had like fucking explosions out of motherfucking chests.
Yes. My favorite Stargate episode was one of the Showtime episodes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I had just gotten addicted to it on like regular. It was coming on. It was like syndicated, and then it got moved to Showtime. I was like, I don't have cable. How the fuck am I supposed to watch this shit. But then that was when I found I could download illegal shit on the internet and then, you know, keep my addiction going.
There you go. Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. But and anyway.
Penultima just called you Hannibal the IMDb animal. I like that. See, that's how this motherfucker keeps up on point.
I look, listen, I'm already look, writing
Zoe,
down.
Zoe already started points. Writing. So. All right. While y'all are writing plunger points, we'll go with, since we're back to a weekly schedule, we're back to normal. Since I've been in France, I'm feeling like we're doing the show normal. We haven't done a regular shit show yet since then, so I'm still a little antsy. But this will be the third since we've been back. Weekly amazing. Let's see what Jesse Lee Peterson was talking about this week. But I will warn you, listen close, because Jesse Lee Peterson has bullshit audio. And I saw that super chat come in or nickel chat come in.
It came from Pussy Crusher 6669. See, I'm giving you plunger points for your name being Pussy Crusher 6669. Because it's three sixes, but then it's also 69. There's a lot of shit, there's a lot of nuance in that shit. And it's perverted as hell. So I think there's a lot of things in there. He gave us $10. He says, finally get to catch you guys live. Finally!
Thank you. So
also, and shout out to Amy Klobuchar last night on the debates for having her eyebrows drawn on like The Rock. So she always looked like she was doing the people's eyebrow the whole night. You know what I'm saying? I think she did that as an intimidation factor. I don't know if it worked for her, but she did it.
Yeah. So let's see what amazing shit Jesse Lee Peterson was talking about. And as I was saying, his audio kind of dips low because I don't know what the fuck they're doing on the Jesse Lee Peterson show.
Drugging them with Xanax. That's what they're doing.
Yeah. Fix your shit. It gets really low and it sounds weird. So open your ears so you can hear this amazing. Here we go.
It's amazing. 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 Racism has never existed.
Amazing.
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 A dirty woman.
You love white people.
You know, I think I want to say this to you, Reverend Jesse. I think that because you serve as such a powerful, powerful tool to our 464-year-old open enemy, I want to congratulate you on being nominated for what we call the Coon Award.
I got that. I have one right here. Look.
Everybody that's watching us, please put your digital hands together.
You see
and
it?
Congratulate our Reverend Jesse Lee Peterson for working on behalf of white supremacy and against his own people.
What's a
by
coon?
Asking, by hustling, by being a race hustler.
What's
put
a coon?
This is for you, sir.
What is a
this
coon?
This is for you.
So
a coon.
What is a coon?
Yes, a coon, exhibit A would be, of course, you.
Because today is going to be
amazing.
Amazing. Amazing. Amazing. Amazing. Amazing.
I forgot about it. That's awesome.
Yes. So this is Jesse Lee Peterson's second Coon Award.
Yeah.
Because I like how he's ready. He's like, I got one.
I got one. Got one right here.
He was like, I got one of those. What is a coon? You nigga, you the cool, you.
That Uncle Ruckus motherfucking ass motherfucker.
Yeah.
Talking about how he was happy on the fucking plantation, man. If I ever, man.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah.
The fucking rape apologist motherfucker, like.
Yeah.
Like.
He said he got Jesse Lee Peterson got that reverse vitiligo.
You know what? This motherfucker would be so much better if, you know, he came out the end of last year talking about how he hasn't masturbated in the 22nd fucking years.
Bullshit. I don't believe
the shit.
That's why he's all fucked up, right?
Exactly.
Yep. Yep.
Sweet.
Yep.
Eat some of that sweet white nectar.
Yeah. Jesse, you gotta bust that nut. Get it out.
That's all it is, man. You know what I'm saying? He just pent up. That's all it is.
Yeah. Yeah. However you got to do it, legally. Yeah. Legally, Jesse. Legally. your hand is fine. Like, do what you got to do.
That shit is awesome. That shit is hilarious. She went. Can we just point out that chick went and got a trophy made?
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I've never done in my life? I was like, man, you know what I want to go do? Make a trophy. Like, there's never been any occasion where I was just like, there was no occasion that I was like, man, you know what would really make this shit better? A trophy. Like, you know what I'm going to do for Thanksgiving this year is, like, I'm just going to get a trophy for the turkey.
Yeah.
So that's it. Just have a trophy there. Just sit it next to the turkey. Like, good job, turkey. You did the thing. And we just got a new subscriber. I'm sorry. I hate that the sound isn't working because the sound is so awesome. We just got subscribed by the Shadow Priest. So thank you very much for subscribing, Shadow Priest. And we're going to have a good time because tonight we are talking about terrible comic book movies that were picked on. We about to pick on them. You guys picked for the show, and we about to talk some shit about them. So let's do this.
Speaking of picking on, but I want to go back before I see my segue got fucked up. We also forgot to mention that on the Sublime episode that's coming up, Emily the Neighbor will be on the shit show talking Sublime with us.
Nice.
Oh. Yeah.
Yeah. She's coming with stories of meeting Brad Noel's dad. Like, shit. Like, so it's going to be fun. But speaking of picked on, before we get into the episode, we got a little picked on in the middle of the night, but our name wasn't mentioned. So my second question, Hannibal, is, are you ready for some G shit?
No, I'm not. I thought we were done with G-Man. I thought we were over. I thought that was all done.
Well, let's check this out. I think let's Snoop say what we think. Here we go.
I think they in the mood for some motherfucking G shit. So right.
What up, dog? I refuse to interact with anybody else on the internet, and I am getting off of here for good. I am entertaining deleting all of my YouTube channels because I'm sick and tired of the garbage that's going on here online. I'm tired of it. I can't even offer my opinion on here no more without somebody dropping my personal information on here.
I was on Dry. I don't watch his channel. I'm sorry. You're going to have to give me a link or something because y'all think I'm joking around. I do not watch his channel no more. The only thing I actually think is decent on that channel is the intro about me. Other than that, who cares? You got the audacity. Matter of fact, I'm going to listen to that right now, actually. Didn't I say I was gonna respond to that garbage? I actually got a catchy tune to it. I gotta put this on here. Hold on. This actually got a pretty catchy tune. Here we go. I'm gonna listen to this. You know the funny thing about it is, what I'm going to do is gonna be so much better than this. It's not even funny.
Oh, that's hilarious.
What I'm going to do is going to be mean, but you know what? I'm thinking about not doing it now, but I'm definitely going to do something with this. So I got to do something with this or I will not be G-Man. I got to do something. This guy's got a little catchy, nice little beat. I want to know, who's the YouTuber that made this? Can somebody tell me who's the YouTuber? Who was the one who made this? I wonder if I can get permission to use this for my anti-atheist podcast. I wonder if I can use this for permission. I actually like this. This is actually pretty good. Somebody in the atheist community finally did something right. That's pretty cool. You got the audacity. That's a nice intro, though. You got the audacity.
You can't help yourself.
I don't know what they mean. You got the audacity. I'm listening to that again. If you guys don't mind, I'll listen to that one more time. I thought this was kind of cool.
Oh, that's good. Because you don't want to like it.
I want to know who made this. Can somebody tell me who made this so I can give them a shout out on my YouTube channel? Who made this this video?
At least we know he can't read. Or
whatever the heck you guys call this.
Okay, that's better. All right. Look, check this out. All right, so this is the live chat while he was doing this stream. Okay. And you'll notice in the comments, let me make sure I'm on the right one. So, oh, I can read it here. Like, there's Crow Mini Clouds. Hannibal made it. Zoe, write Crow Mini Clouds down. Crow Mini Clouds gets a fucking 50 plunger points for being in there. And and then there's Matt Bond, another 50 plunger points for saying, G-Man is afraid of the people that made this song. Facts. And have proven that he's afraid of us because he's seen us before. And we're going to let this go a little more. I'll show you these screenshots later. So play, hit play, hit play. Let's show the rest. We're almost done.
Who made this? Like, who made this? I want to contact this person. Who made this? Who made this? Okay, I'm pitiful. I can't walk, can't read bubblegum and all that. Can't eat bubblegum and walk or whatever. Who did this?
All right. Here's another string. He's looking at the chat the entire time. And there's Matt Bond again. Another 50 for him. Matt Bond says, Hannibal and Monty, they're always in your chat, which I am under the Hannibal and Monty account. Whenever he goes live, I'm like, hey, motherfucker, it's us. And he says, he's scared of them. Then you go down a little more. There's Matt Bond again. He's afraid to say their name because he's been looking at the chat the entire time. Then there's Sock Maggie. He says, I love that he doesn't realize he's an attention whore. Right under that, it says, they invited you to their show, you liar. Facts. Plunger points for Humboldt Hipneck.
Humboldt? Shout out to Humboldt. All right.
Yeah. Yeah. So wait. You gotta see what happens next. Go, play more.
I'm an attention whore. Who's the dummy watching me?
Humboldt. Or right before, Sock Maggie, I love that he doesn't realize he's an attention whore. Sandwiched between the two comments that said it was fucking us.
Apologize, my nigga.
I got you, bro.
Say sorry, nigga. Sorry.
Man.
Maybe he thinks this is the torture for us, that he's not crediting us. Like, he keeps saying, who did this?
But, you know, look, here's the thing. Y'all say that. This motherfucker makes my brain hurt. Zoe, hit the next thing. Like, look at this. Look at this. I commented on that episode, or on that stream of his, and I said, we keep telling you, G-Man, and in all caps, we made that song, because I've told him in every live stream I've been talking about. This motherfucker responds by saying, you made the song? Got proof? Sorry. These days, I don't trust anyone who's an atheist.
Wait, what?
That's what he said. So...
Wait. We're taking credit for the thing that nobody else is taking credit for. Everybody says we did it, and we said we did it, and he's like, nah, I need some proof. You know what this is like? This is like September 11th. You know what I'm saying? Bunch of planes got flown into some buildings and shit, and then everybody's like, well, who did it? And then the Taliban stands up, and Osama bin Laden's like, yeah, we did that shit. Fuck y'all. Get out the Middle East. And George Bush was like, man, I think Saddam Hussein did this. It's like, no, he just told you who did this shit. He literally just said it. Like, this is the first time that I've ever had to, like, prove that I was guilty of something.
Yeah. Yeah. What the fuck? Crazy. What the fuck? Like, I don't know how else to show it to you, G-Man. But look, 2/3 of Team MFN is right there. That's who made the song.
Yeah,
I edited the video.
Say
so. Me and this guy behind down below, Ace Wonder and myself, we made it. And we made it real quick. Like, it took about 10 minutes.
Like, you want to see the fucking process? We filmed the shit. But Like, we can show you if you want, but I don't think you're worth the effort. Because, as I said the last time, in one of the last, the other two G-Man episodes, you're a bitch.
Yeah, so, he's definitely got bitch tendencies. And yeah. and to be fair, I'm talking about female dogs. I am talking about female dogs. I am not, that is not a pejorative about females. We are just talking about dogs of the female variety. I was going somewhere with that and I lost. I wanted to make sure I was being PC. I was like, fuck it. Yeah. So G-Man, when I say you're being a bitch, I'm saying you are the backup Lassie dog. Okay. Yep. That's what I'm saying.
Yep.
Okay.
So that just got us kicked off Facebook, I'm sure, because that's what happened last time. But that's okay. Sorry, Facebook.
So calling him a bitch got us kicked off Facebook?
I'm pretty sure. Pretty sure. Pretty sure.
What?
I don't.
So let me talk about this coward ass motherfucking 14-year-old that looked like he got Benjamin Button disease. I offered to have a conversation with this asshole.
Yep.
He go to my YouTube page. How you a dragoon?
Oh yeah, he'll hit you with that shit real fast. Yeah. Oh, you a dragoon. Like what?
Yeah.
Now keep in mind. See, this is the reason why I have a problem with this motherfucking idiot. One, I almost turned out like him with that whole religious shit, not thinking. But two, he is a fucking poor representation of a fucking North or North almost Eastern African-American, because he owned that whole, I think that he has some developmental issues, but he's purposefully stupid and malicious.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Now, I never thought I would meet somebody who would break Haplin's razors for me. But this motherfucker here, because you never attribute a malice, which can easily be attributed to stupidity.
Mm-hmm.
But the motherfucker breaks it. I have to add conditions for his ass. Not only malice, stupidity, cowardice, and fucking greed.
Ooh. Yeah. Okay.
Damn it.
Yeah. G-Man, it's a problem. Like, I don't know what more proof you need. I'm clipping this out, and I am going to address this video when I post it to you.
Loken 16 says, please never underestimate how stupid G-Man is. I have watched him for years.
Oh, yeah. I don't underestimate his stupidity, but, or maybe I did. But, you know, I don't think this is stupidity. He is consciously ignoring us. So, there you go. There's your positive claim, G-Man. I don't have any real proof, just what I see. But you don't know how to work with that. Like, I'm being up front with it. Come talk to me. So, but that being said, we're done with G-Man. Like, I don't want to spend this whole show talking about G-Man. Now, we need to get into the shit. So, I sat today and I edited up these things because we need something special for the Ultimate Comic Book Show, Comic Book Movie List episodes, and something for the torture episodes. So we're going to play them both back to back. But first, let's get into the torture episode. Here we go. Here's the intro for the torture, because this shit's about to happen.
Hello. I want to play a game.
Yes. Yes. It is time for a torture episode.
I like that you find a way every episode to just find some Team MFN music just to use to just sprinkle in the background of
That's because I want all motherfuckers to know, if you want the fucking beats, that half of the screen, that's where they came from.
Yes, this is that's right. We're doing all the music.
All also, the shit
real quick, Monty. Bob Newman says your science is no match for my ignorance, and you know, and you can just literally hear all the G-Man quotes, so, you know, in that
G-Man. Yeah. I like that.
Yeah. All right. It rhymes with, you know,
it rhymes with something. G-Man. Yeah. Rhymes with something. You know. Like, you know, demon. It rhymes with demon.
It does. It does rhyme with demon.
Yeah.
Well, you know, what else does it rhyme with?
What's a
salty drink that I forget it. What's next?
Are you talking about what the Holy Spirit keeps his mind from thinking about?
Yeah. Oh,
Holy.
Jesus.
Yes, yes.
I was thinking of a creamy, salty beverage.
Yeah, I don't know what that is. I don't know what that is. But this is also another entry into the ultimate comic book movie list. Yes. Play that for me, Zoe.
Let me take it to the movie, shawty. I'm sure later on you will be my baby.
There you go. That beat was not made by Team MFN.
Absolutely not.
just so you know.
No disrespect to that beat, maybe a little bit, but not Team MFN. So, we're about to talk about these movies for this torture episode. Hannibal already broke down the list, and going oldest to newest, first, we get Howard the Duck from August the 1st, 1986. So, Hannibal, you got any information, any fun facts give us about this movie?
Yes, I'm gonna give you guys a couple quick facts about Howard the Duck if you didn't already know. So first things first, George Lucas said that, let me not do that one right now. Okay, the movie was nominated for 7 Golden Raspberry Awards in 1986, including Worst Director, Worst Original Song, and Worst Supporting Actor. The picture won 4 Razzies for Worst New Star for the 6 people that had to wear the duck costume, Worst Visual Effects, Worst Screenplay, and Worst Picture, which was tied with Cherry Moon. So that's the first thing. The second thing is the evil overlord is based on the Marvel villain who originally brought Howard the Duck to Earth. His full title in the comics is Thog the Netherspawn, Overmaster of Somnus. Right?
All right.
And the last fact for you, and this is my favorite of all the facts about Howard the Duck. According to the reports at the time of the movie's release, George Lucas had just built his $50 million Skywalker Ranch complex and was counting on the film to get him back in the black. When the movie bombed at the box office, he was forced to start selling off assets to stay afloat. His friend Steve Jobs, the at the time CEO of Apple Computer, offered to buy Lucasfilm's newly launched CGI animation division for a price that was well above the market value. Lucas, in desperate straits at the time and thankful for the financial assistance, ended up selling his new CGI animation division. That division was Pixar.
Right.
Wow. All right.
So because Howard the Duck did so poorly, George Lucas sold a very early developmental version of Pixar to Apple, to Tim Cook. I mean,
Steve Jobs.
Yeah, Steve Jobs. Thank you. And that's where Pixar came from.
All right. And in the end, Disney owns them all.
Wow. Yeah.
The
most jarring thing about that is that George Lucas didn't see that L coming.
And this, like Mark said,
August 1st, 1986. Some of you were born, some of you weren't. But we got this movie. We're gonna fucking talk about it.
There's nobody that wasn't born then.
No, we got people in our chat that weren't even born when this movie came out.
No, I don't believe it.
So if I remember right about this movie, they made him do this movie in order to get another movie done.
Oh,
is that what it is? He had to do this movie so he could get the one that he wanted.
Yeah.
That would make more sense.
Yeah. All right.
Sir Marvin Manister, big fucking L. Yeah, George Lucas took a big the big L in his name was for him selling Pixar. Is what that was.
Yeah. All right. Well,
and E.M. Dubois says, so you mean to tell me Jar Jar Binks could have been in the Toy Story movie?
Oh.
And you know what the worst thing about that is? George Lucas would have fucking did that shit.
Yeah.
He would fucking do that shit.
And Vapion, like, I'm glad I'm not the only one that saw the duck boobs in this movie. Thank you, Vapion.
Corkscrew penis.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. All right.
Yeah. So the way this works is we each have 3 minutes to talk about our thoughts on this movie. And Hannibal had a good breakdown for it. What's your breakdown? Like, on what to go over in those 3 minutes, Hannibal?
What I normally do is I'll give, like, my summary of how I felt about the movie and then briefly talk about some of the stuff I like, some of the stuff I disliked about the movie. And just, you know, that's how I structure it when I'm talking about it. Because I just start writing my shit out so I don't be long-winded because I've gotten accused of that for some reason.
But we'll see how it plays out. Like, I'm not going to call you long-winded. We'll let the shitheads and Crimson, who's new in our house, decide if you're long-winded. So, 3 minutes, we're going to let Hannibal go first.
Okay.
Just to show you how the clock works.
But see, I'm not going to go long on Howard the Duck. Matter of fact, I should go last on this one. You should go first.
I don't think I'm going to run out the clock on this.
No, I don't know if anybody's going to run out the clock. Yeah. Well, I'm not going to run out the clock on this one.
I mean, if you want to start it with me. We can start it with me. I'm fine with
that.
Okay,
let's do it.
The order it'll go in, it'll be me, since it starts with me then. It'll start with me, then Crimson, then Ace Wonder, then Hannibal. Then, when we get to the movie after, it'll be Crimson, then Ace Wonder, then Hannibal, then me. And we'll just keep rotating until we get to the end. And Hoosier Atheist just sent us a $20.
I see it. He says, your science is no match. No, I'm sorry. It hasn't come in yet. It's gonna pop up on my screen, and then I'm gonna read it as soon as I see it. Hoosier Atheist.
Yes.
Shout out to Hoosier Atheist. You're awesome all the time.
Yeah. You're all. Thank you, Hoosier Atheist, for buying the shirt.
He says, I'm not trying to influence anyone's opinion, but it's hard for me to hate a movie that has Leah Thompson in her underwear. That is facts. That is definitely facts.
Truth. Yeah, that was one of my favorite scenes. Like, yeah. I kind of wanted to see the sex scene with Howard the Duck. Start my time. I would have watched it and been creepily excited. I will admit it. I'm not ashamed of it. Do what you want with it. Clip that shit out. Bad shit about Monty, but I own it, so I don't give a fuck. but yeah, Howard the Duck, I saw, and I will stand on and die on this fucking hill on this show. Howard the Duck is the best movie of these movies that we watched.
Ooh, okay.
I will say that right now. It is the best of these five movies. Of these five movies, if only these five movies were ever made, this is the best movie ever made.
It's the one I enjoyed the most.
Same.
And it's also story-wise, like, subtracting all the suspend disbelief moments, it's the one that makes the most sense from beginning to end, because there's a lot of suspend disbelief moments. I told Hannibal on the phone, the smart choice in this movie was they started in Duck World. You start the movie in Duck World, and immediately you think to yourself, okay,
all right,
this is where we are. So we leave Duck World and go to the real world. You've opened yourself up to stretch logic really, really far. And I like that in the movie, because they told us the rules right out the gate as soon as credits roll. Like, here's what it's like in Duck World. Like, what the fuck is Duck World? Okay, Duck World's a thing. Gotcha. Where do we go from Duck World? Now we can go from Duck World to Earth. And this is normal from weird. Like, that was our bar for normal. Now we're trying to figure out what this world is. I thought that worked. I thought that was a brilliant technique for telling the story of Howard the Duck. It had to be intentional. I'm sure they sat down and said, in order to tell this story, we have to start in Duck World so that we can do all this ridiculous shit you have planned for the plot. Like the fucking demon, like Mr. Rooney from Ferris Bueller running into time. That's the sound. That means I have 30 seconds. So, I gave this movie a C. I think Howard the Duck is a C movie. And, Duck World, up to the demon. I, for myself, liking the movie, I give it an A as far as what I like. But the movie itself gets a C.
All right, Monty. Monty, and you did the time. That is interesting. Okay, Monty, I'm writing your grade down. Monty gives it a C.
Yeah.
Crimson 60620. What did you think about?
And wait, before Crimson gets in, do you get how it works? You got 3 minutes. Once you hear Mario die, you're done talking. You got it?
Yo.
All right, here we go. Start his time.
All right. Go. First thing I saw, within 5 minutes of the movie, I felt like I wanted some fucking KFC. Because all I saw was breasts. Now, I couldn't fucking realize basically, old girl treated Howard like either the cross between a pet and the best boyfriend in the world. I got some reverse King Kong vibes out this shit.
Okay, yeah, I got
it. You can tell in his world, Howard is a fucking lame, because nobody that is somebody that, let's just say, has sex a lot, keeps an open condom in their wallet.
Yep. That's nasty.
Like, what do you do? Reuse it and roll it back up?
Real talk. I don't know what they was doing back in 85, man, but
niggas in Duckland leaving savage.
They was just discovering HIV, so they were just keeping used condoms. Like, forget it.
Yeah, now, like, I'm gonna roll this back up. I can use it again, bitch.
Oh,
you must think I'm made of coins to just buy more condoms.
I gotta throw this shit away after I use it? Fuck that. But no, it was actually some great character development between the two of them. That's my big thing with the story. If you actually see the character development, it was actually fucking great. One thing is, it had some shitty ass editing though, because I would have put the fucking diner scene, at least with the motherfuckers actually his ass, closer to the beginning of the movie versus towards the fucking end when you have shit to accomplish. And who was that? The fucking lab assistant?
Tim Robbins.
He was fucking awesome in that motherfucking movie. Like, he has, like, that's, like, he reminds me of so many other fucking characters. Like, oh yeah, absent-minded motherfucking whatever that doesn't know his head from a hole in that, from his hole in the ass. And the fact that it was just, besides, it was a totally 80s movie. It was just this quintessential 80s fucking movie. And damn, like, I am glad now that they can actually have a time to remake this shit, because he is literally in the MCU. Fucking Howard the Duck movie. Done.
There you go. There you go. You beat the time. You beat the time.
Awesome. So, based on our grading scale, what grade would you give the movie Crimson?
Character development, give it a B, but the rest of the shit, it's a D, so I guess I'd average it out to like a C-.
C-, okay.
All right. C- is fair. C- is fair. All right. Well, let's head on over to Ace Wonder. Let me know as soon as you start talking, I'm going to start your time.
Nah, man. Go ahead. I'm going to start with my grade, because my grade is the same as Crimson. I gave it a C- as well, but I actually enjoyed this movie, but I think a big part of it was the nostalgia. You know, I seen this movie a bunch as a kid, but the first thing that jumped out to me is that as a kid, we must have been watching like the PG-13 Channel 26 version, because there was a lot of stuff in here that I didn't remember. You know, like, yeah, like the topless duck, like right off the bat. And yeah. I'm sitting in the living room with my kid, man. Like, yeah, so that caught me off guard. But what I started to realize after watching all of these movies, I started to appreciate some of the story things you guys were talking about with Howard the Duck. It's like, yeah, it looks horrible, but in the end, it was put together better than Fantastic Four.
Oh, you know?
You know what I mean? It was written and connected better than that. So I had to give credit where credit was due. So, yeah, I enjoyed it. I do recognize it for, you know, as being a garbage movie, but I enjoyed it. But I give it a C-, to be fair.
All right. All right.
Before we move on, I want to say one thing. Also, I wanted to see, because of this shit, is a Spider-Ham movie. How did Duck and Spider-Ham team up?
We talked about that on the Spider-Man episode, actually. I don't know if you remember that, Hannibal.
Yeah. No, yeah. No, I don't. But I do. I remember you talking about it on the show, but I've never seen it before. So I've never seen the thing that you're referencing.
No, it hasn't happened. Like, it should happen. A Spider-Ham movie.
Okay. Yeah. They should definitely do a Spider-Ham movie. They should do a Spider-Ham movie, but John Mulaney has to do the voice of Spider-Ham. I will accept no one else doing his voice now that I've heard John Mulaney do it.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
I've actually recently become a fan of his stand-up, and I've been watching a bunch of his stand-up shits, and I've been like, fuck, this dude is funny. Why have I haven't been watching this shit before?
Yeah. It's an acquired taste, but if you could get into it, it's pretty decent.
Yeah. It is. I like his delivery because I like his time, and I like his delivery. You go ahead and start my time, Monty. So of all the movies that we had to watch on this list, this was my favorite movie to watch. I was young. I saw this movie so many fucking times. And even watching it now, it was like, this shit was just like, man, I remember all of this shit. Like, I know what scene is coming up next. I'm quoting lines and shit. I'm just like I know what's coming before it gets there. You know, watching fucking, watching Howard, a.k.a., or as the Honest Trailer people put it, a Snarkwing Duck. it was super fun to watch this again. It just brought me back to all those old memories I had when I was young. I can remember the scene where the scientist ends up being the bad guy at the end of the movie, like sticks his tongue out and then sticks it into the fucking lighter socket. You know what I'm saying? And I remember that shit freaking me the fuck out as a child. I remember the duck titties. I remember the Howard the Duck song. I remember the chords this nigga played when he was at Leah Thompson's apartment playing the motherfucking keyboard and shit. Like, I remember Holly Robinson Pete was in the motherfucking band that this motherfucker was in. I was like, looking at this movie like, oh my God, this shit is fat. It's so, just everything about it is just, it was nostalgic. But this is not a good movie. Right? this is not a good movie. And I thoroughly loved this movie. But it is not good. All right. Leah Thompson, nobody seems to be surprised of this duck man walking around Earth. Like, nobody. It was just like, and then they were in Cleveland. So of all places, people of Cuyahoga County for sure would have freaked out seeing this duck person. Like I said, I suspended my disbelief in this movie a lot. I enjoyed it, but I'm somewhere between a C- and a D+. And I enjoyed this movie. I really, really, really like this movie. But some of the dialogue in this shit is not good. It's just like I think some of the acting and some of the dialogue isn't great. But I let it go because I was a kid and I thought it was dope. And even now, as I look at this movie, I don't know who they made this movie for, because they did not make this movie for kids to like in 1986, but they also did not make this movie for adults to watch in 1986. This is one of those movies that, like, it comes out and it's bad when it comes out, but then years later, it develops kind of like a cult following, and then, somewhere between C minus D plus. Before the show's over, I'm gonna think about it. I'm leaning towards C minus right now. I'm leaning towards the C-, though. And that might be peer pressure from you guys. So.
All right. Fair enough.
But we're all in the ballpark right now. Monty's the high man. And if I give it the D plus, and I'm the low man. So. All right.
All right.
Also, one last quick fact about this. On the DVD commentary of the film, one of the commenters, one of the claims that George Lucas made was that 20 years later, this movie would be seen as a masterpiece. As of 2012, the movie was still considered one of the worst movies ever made. So,
this is not one of the worst movies ever made.
Yeah, well, I did. So, I think this movie got real popular to shit on because of what it was at the time and who made it. This was the biggest B movie, the biggest budget B movie to ever come out. Because this is this is like a Sci-Fi Channel original picture that was released in major theaters that had a huge ass push. It's a B movie that had a big ass budget.
Yeah.
And you know the sad part about it is people remember it more for the movie than the actual multi-decade run publication that he had.
This is true. This is true. I didn't know Howard the Duck had a comic for years.
Right.
And I can remember buying comic books, passing the Howard the Duck comic book, thinking that it was a Donald Duck comic book, and then passing over it. And I think one day I saw him like giving somebody the finger, and I was like, "Oh shit, that's not Howard the Duck at all." we just got a new subscriber just now. If I say your name wrong, I apologize. You know, tell us in the chat how to phonetically say it. Hongorjan B. If I fucked it up, I apologize. Tell me how to say it so that way I can say it right, because I don't want to make sure I say it wrong.
Pop in the chat. You just got a boost of plunger points.
Yeah.
Become a shithead. Join us. Join the Discord, all of it. You're welcome here. Be part of the family.
Yeah. And also, everybody, for everybody that's new to the channel, first off, welcome. We're happy to have you guys. We are talking about shitty comic book movies right now. If you have seen a movie and you want to drop your grade in the chat, you can go ahead and drop your grade in the chat. All we ask is that, you know, try not to grade it based on nostalgia. Try to be as objective as possible about it. Like I said, I loved Howard the Duck. This is not a good movie, though. Like, I would not tell somebody, man, you know what's a good movie? Howard the Duck. Like, that's not a, like, if I met somebody and they said that Howard the Duck was their favorite movie of all time, if I was single and I met a girl who was interested in me and she said Howard the Duck was her favorite movie of all time, I would not date her. I would think she has questionable judgment.
Or I mean, she likes animals.
Look, so first off, she's already dating a nigga wearing a mask, so I already can't trust her judgment, okay? Something wrong with that bitch.
So there we go. Howard the Duck. So we've come all the way around. Crimson's next to go first, so we'll move on to the next movie.
Yes.
Which is from June 17th, 2003.
Yeah. Ang Lee's Hulk. Wait, no. Yeah, you're right. Right. Okay. I was looking at it. I was like, no, that's not right. I'm going to give you guys a couple quick facts about this movie. First fact, Edward Norton was initially approached to play Bruce Banner, but he turned it down because even though he was a huge fan of the Hulk comics, he did not like the script. That's why he signed on later to be in the Incredible Hulk movie, but not to be in Ang Lee's Hulk. He saw the script and was like, nah, pass. Nick Nolte, so some of you guys may or may not have seen, there's an infamous photo of Nick Nolte getting arrested by the cops, and he has this awful DUI photo with his hair sticking out all crazy and shit. That photo came, like, he got arrested with that DUI while he was filming this movie. So you see how his movie's all, and his, like, Nick Nolte's hair in this Hulk movie is all wild and crazy?
Wow. Like,
that picture from that DUI was from him while he was filming this movie.
Oh,
yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I know. It's a deep dive on random facts. The scene where they blow up the frog in the microwave or whatever the fuck that was, that was not a real frog. It was a fake frog, and they pumped it with air to make it look like it was breathing before they blew it up. to show the cast where the Hulk would be standing, because the Hulk is a CGI rendered thing, they basically used a cardboard cutout of the Incredible Hulk, and they would just put it on set, and everybody would have to talk and interact with the Hulk on a stick. Last fact is Eric Banner, who played Bruce Banner, and Sam Elliott, who played General Thunderbolt Ross, are both born on August 9th.
Yeah. Also, fun fact, the Hulk is literally Ang Lee. He pretended to be the Hulk. In the CGI, they captured him as the Hulk. That's who is the mocap actor.
Interesting.
I didn't know that. All right. Well, that being said, Crimson, the floor is yours for 3 minutes.
All right. So here's the thing. I actually know a little bit about the history of the Hulk, so I respect them for trying to do the abusive father bullshit, but it was just totally bullshit the way they did it. Fact is, this is why I hate fucking comic book movies, because they always, this and the other horrible movies we're going to talk about, because they always try to throw in the catchphrases of the fucking people. And the best thing that came out of this fucking movie, the very best thing, is Hulk Ultimate Destruction. That 64 game. Other than that, this shit was complete trash. Fucking trash. And the fact that I watched it at 1.25 speed and the shit was still slow to me lets me know that this is bullshit. Any fucking Incredible Hulk movie that you see that does not have him talking at least in some kind of fucking way, broken English or not, I fucking hate it. Because not Bruce Banner, I don't give two shits about Bruce Banner, but I love the fucking Hulk. It reminds me of the motherfucking, it reminds me of fucking Frankenstein. And this shit about, oh, the torture scientist, Bruce Banner can go suck start a shotgun. I want to see the Hulk. That's why, when I saw this movie on the list, I got angry. I got angry. And the fact that they tried to do a comic book movie and actually quite literally took a fucking, try to do comic book panels, it's the same reason I want to smack Zack Snyder. It's a fucking movie. And the whole thing about telling and not showing, it's a fucking movie. And I'm just pissed because this technically is in the chronology of the better Incredible Hulk movie, because they reference this movie. Not in the same actors, but they reference this movie as part of the backstory in that first few clips of the one that Marvel originally adapted into the MCU. I'm done. You had to drag old poor Stan Lee into this. You had to drag poor Luke Fregno. Fuck it. I'm so pissed I can't say his name.
All right. What's your grade for the movie?
Kill it with fire. Fucking F.
Ooh, all right. Ooh. Crimson with the hard F. I like it. All right. Ace Wonder, what say you, sir?
All right. Well, it's kind of hard to follow that one up. But, for me, it was, I felt like I could get what they were trying to do. But in the end, when it came down to it, it took too long for them to do it. And it wasn't nearly enough action. Once they got to the action, I was mildly satisfied with it at times, even though I didn't like the CGI too much on the actual Hulk. But I could deal with the action. It just wasn't enough of it, you know. And I felt like Ang Lee was trying to, like, explore, like, the real emotional content of these characters, which I can give him credit for. But it also made me realize that that's not what I want from the Hulk. I really, you know, I want some of that, but I really just want to see him smash some shit and smash some people. And I didn't get enough of that movie, so I gave it a C-.
All right.
And with the emotional, I want to respond to that. If you gave me World War Hulk or Planet Hulk in live action, where he's emotional as shit, but he still goes around and he literally told Black Bolt, other fucking Inhumans, I didn't hear that. Come here to hear you whisper. I came to hear you scream.
Yeah. He. Oh yeah. He got gangster for sure.
Yeah. But
go ahead, Monty.
Yeah, the thing is, we're judging these movies, and you have to do your best when grading these to separate what happened in the comics and judge this movie just as a movie.
Oh yeah, it's unfortunate, though. This movie was just so boring, man.
Yeah, no. I agree with, honestly, everything both of y'all said. I agree with one of your grades. One, I'm like, not so much. I won't say which one.
Okay, so, all right, let me do this. So, it's funny. I saw a comedian. You start my time, Monty.
All right, handle's turn.
I saw a comedian. Zoe, start my time, darling. And also, shout out to our lovely producer, Zoe, you know, because whenever we don't have her here, it is an actual shit show. I saw a comedian when this movie come out, says, he said, I went and saw the Hulk movie. He says, and I wasn't bored for a single minute. I was bored for 224 minutes.
That's real.
And I think that's a pretty good way to talk about the movie. Look, the Hulk, Ang Lee's Hulk is a comic book movie. That is also a monster movie. That is also a Greek tragedy. And what? You will either love or hate this film based on whether or not you love or hate Ang Lee's vision for the movie. Like, because there's certain questions you have to ask yourself. Like, he stylizes the movie to make it look like a comic book. Was that cool or was that corny? Are the performers brooding and tense, or are they boring and lifeless? Is the music ominous, or is it over the top? Is the dogfight scene amazing or just ass? You know what I'm saying? Right. And these are the questions, like, and based on how you answer those questions, that's going to determine how you feel about this movie. For me, I didn't mind, and I've never hated this movie. Like, there's things about this movie that I definitely don't like. Like, there's a lot of stuff that I didn't like about this movie. Like, I think the mutant dog fight is dumb as shit. I thought that shit was fucking awful when I saw it in the theater. I thought it was dumb every time I've seen it on video, and I felt like it was dumb when I watched it recently. And the ending, you know, when Nick Nolte becomes a big ball of gamma water, right, and then gets blown up by gamma, is just... And that was just like, yeah, Ang Lee, you never read these books before, have you? Like, you just kind of just made some shit up and was just like, that's cool. And those are genuinely awful scenes. But on the other hand, the scene where the Hulk is trapped in the desert and has to escape the desert and get to San Francisco, that whole scene, I think, is awesome. You know, short of the scene of him just staring at rocks, which is just, I don't know why that's there. Ang Lee does a whole lot of rock staring in this movie. You know, the end scene where, like, Nick Nolte and Eric Banner are sitting down in the room talking to each other, you know, and he's just like, yeah, I don't want to talk to my son. And they're going this back scene. And forth to shit. And then fucking Eric Banner, like, yeah, I was like, no! And then Nick Nolte sits down and he imitates, yeah. Like, that shit is fantastic. That is a good fucking scene. So I can't give this movie an L because there's things about it that are good. There's things about it that are terrible. The pacing is the big issue. I gave it a C-. I'm with Daryl. I gave it a C-. And it's not a fun movie to watch. Like, I wouldn't recommend. Like, I'm going to tell everybody, if you haven't seen it, you should see it just because. But it's not a great movie.
All right. Well, I'm going to go quick. Just start the time right now, Zoe. I agree with everything all of you said, like, except I would say this movie is separating myself from any Hulk comic I've ever read. Just looking at this is a movie about a guy that turns into a green beast. It's a Jekyll and Hyde story of a guy turning into a green beast.
Yeah.
It was decent enough. It wasn't like separating any knowledge of comics. Like, this is what it is. The Hulk dogs didn't bother me. me, because the Hulk dogs are honestly only a problem if you're a Hulk fan. Like, that's when they become a problem. Because it's like, why are we fighting Hulk dogs? We know what happens with the Hulk. We know where it goes. But if it's just a sci-fi movie, Hulk dogs kind of make sense. Like, this dude's experimenting on all kinds of crazy shit. Why wouldn't he experiment on his lovely pooches? That's what he did. So it all fell into the realm of believability for me. And the movie itself was not good, not bad. Ended up at the same as Hannibal and Ace Wonder, a C minus.
I knew you were going to, I already wrote down that you gave it a C minus before you even said the grade.
Yeah. Yeah. This is a C minus movie. I wouldn't recommend it if it were on. And I had shit to do, I probably wouldn't change the channel because I'm like, you know what? I can just look up and see some shit every now and then. I'll keep doing what I'm doing.
For me, it's a lot about the characters. It's just like, you could have had this not Hulk.
Yeah.
That's my problem. And you didn't associate, you just said, ooh, big green monster. And that's my problem.
Yeah.
Now, if you would associate it, fuck. If you would associate it with big dumb green monster. If they would have used Marvel original Hulk, the hairy kind and shit like that, that'd have been cool. But the fact that you like taking this character and not even associated with just, oh, I'm angry. That's my big betrayal. Like, you can have different interpretations of a character, but where it's just like, hey, window dressing. That's where I get upset. Now, besides of the 2.5 hour movie, an hour and 45 minutes is spending with you looking at character's face, looking all constipated. Yeah. It would have been an okay movie.
Yeah. And to piggyback on what you're saying, the Hulk doesn't even pop up into the movie until like 45 minutes in.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So that's, it's like, there's a lot. And I also did like you did. I watched this movie sped up like 1.5. And even watching it sped up, it shit was still slow as hell. It's like, damn, this shit is dragging.
This movie reminds me of one of them Godzilla movies that came out in the late 90s, early 2000s, where they made you wait forever to finally get the payoff. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. You had to wait a long time for you talking about the one that the one that had
the big pal of fish.
And Scarlet Witch in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
That's a big pal of fish, yeah, with Matthew Broderick. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That was my shit. I love that movie. I love that terrible movie. That movie was terrible, though.
I like the cartoon that came from it. The movie they could have kept.
Yeah. Oh, and to piggyback on something you said earlier, Crimson, most people have that there is a spiritual sequel to this movie. Well, the actual sequel to this movie is in the form of a video game that is like, it is like, people that have played this game says this game is amazing. The story, the voice acting, everything about it is fantastic. And it was like, yeah, if the game had been the movie, that would have been a great movie.
Yeah.
They quite literally reskinned, I think it was the original Spider-Man 2 on the PlayStation. They reskinned it, changed the engine, and actually made it that game. So that's why it's so fucking fun, because they just took that whole Hulk running through the streets and just smashing shit. And I think they also used the same thing for a game called, what was it, Prototype? Mm-hmm. Where the guy got absorbed by a plant, and he's just going around and smashing shit. So yeah, this game had some great, this movie had some great shit that came out of it. It's just that you basically used the Hulk as a fucking rubber stamp to tell a monster movie. If this had just been a monster movie, it would have got slack from me. But the fact that, oh no, throw Hulk on it.
Yeah. I agree. But you know what? Ultimate comic book movie list. We gotta judge it as the movie, so that's what we go with. Like,
all right, you had to get a D from me. I do D.
All right, All right. There we go. There we go. I accept that grade. I accepted your F too.
Yeah, I would have accepted it. Like, look, here's the thing. I if somebody gives this an F, because this movie is going to live and die based on how you feel about the thing. Like I said, the things I said, like, is it, did you like this or did you not like this? And if you liked it, then it was okay. And if you didn't like it, then this movie is awful. It is hard to watch. You know, and like, and the pacing doesn't help. There are a lot of scenes, and I noticed it watching it back. There's a lot of scenes with them just zooming in on rocks with grass growing on it.
Yeah.
I mean, there's that period, end of sentence. That's just there a thing go. That they do in this movie a lot, or, like, way too much.
Or lizards.
Yeah.
Or jellyfishes.
Yeah. 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 Or the starfish. Yeah.
Yeah. So, all right. All right. So,
real quick before we move on. And this is for everybody in the chat and everybody and for Ace One, DeMonte, Crimson. Who's the worst father in the movie? General Thunderbolt Ross or David Banner? Who's the worst daddy? Because, like, Thunderbolt Ross is literally justifying murder because he thinks it's what's best for his daughter. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But... you know, Nick Nolte also infected his son with, you know, with
he's the worst.
I'm gonna have to go David Banner.
I'm gonna say David Banner because, quite literally, he could have, like, oh shit, I turned my son into a monster because I'm half one. Mm-hmm. But it's just, at least he has the excuse of being fucking crazy. Ross is just a craven asshole that thinks more about his fucking career and keep you away from my daughter, motherfucker.
Yeah.
Ross doesn't have the excuse of being fucking crazy. He's just craven.
Yeah, it looks like you know, a lot of the, you know, Shadow Priest in the chat also agrees with you guys. He thinks David Banner is the worst parent. But you know what? I'm going the other way. I think Thunderbolt Ross is the worst parent. You know, for part of the reason that Crimson was saying, like, Nick Nolte is kind of crazy. You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, he did make his son one of the most powerful characters in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Meanwhile, Thunderbolt Ross is like, hey, it is okay for me to kill my daughter's love interest because I didn't like her daddy one time.
But here's my point. He tried to kill the love interest. David Banner tried to kill his own son.
Yeah, but he made him stronger, though. You know what I'm saying? I'm giving him credit for the effect of his actions, not the intent of his actions. Yeah. Well,
LeBron's daddy's out there somewhere cheering you on right now.
I saw a joke one time. The worst thing to be in the fucking Marvel anything is a father. Because look at all the shitty fathers they have in all Marvel comics. Even fucking Odin.
Yeah.
The only good father, ironically, in the Marvel anything is fucking Reed Richards, and he's halfway shitty father.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think Reed Richards might be the best Marvel father, though. Like, in the comics, at least. So.
Him, ironically, and fucking Magneto. To his real kid. Everybody else. Yeah.
Nah, you know what? I'm going to. Damn. See, now you got me fucked up. I would say. I'm going to come back to that one. Monty, what's the next movie?
The next movie came out February 18th, 2000 and motherfucking 5. And it is Mask 2 that we didn't know existed. Son of the Mask. So this goes to Ace Wonder to start talking about. As soon as you start, your time starts.
Wait. Let me give him the quick facts.
Yeah. Give your facts about it.
Let me go ahead and give my quick facts. The film critic Richard Roper admitted that in the 5 years he co-hosted with Roger Ebert, this film was the closest he'd ever come to walking out of a movie. And he says, looking back, he wishes he had walked out. Jim Carrey was asked to reprise his role as Stanley Ipkiss, aka The Mask, and he initially accepted, but then he read the script and then he quit because he said he knew the movie would be a failure. When asked why he agreed to do the film, Jamie Kennedy responded, "I'll give you 2.5 million reasons why." And Jack Black also turned down the role of being in this movie. Yeah, so you know, if Jack Black sees the script and is like, "Nah, I can't do this," then you know it's bad. So
yeah. So, Ace Wonder.
I'm torn whether I want to give this movie an F or F minus. it's definitely worse than the Shaq movie.
Steel? Which one?
Was it Steel?
Yeah.
Steel's garbage, man. But this might be one of the worst movies that I've watched with y'all. To be honest with you. This one might be the bottom of the barrel, man. It's like they needed somebody to replace Jim Carrey. And a big part of what made the first Mask work, and pretty much the only thing that really made that movie work, was Jim Carrey's performance.
Jim Carrey.
And then they replaced him with a dude who just didn't have any of that.
Yep.
Like, even down to like the facial expressions when he was the Mask, it was just nothing, man. It was just garbage. The dance scenes, like yeah, man. I'm going F minus, man. F minus.
All right, we haven't had F minus in a while.
And this is one that made me almost regret. I volunteered for this, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't realize that this was on the list, though. Yeah, all F minus, man. That's what I'm gonna use mine on.
I got you. Okay. Stop my time, Monty. It ain't gonna take me a whole lot of time. I'm saving all my angst for the Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
So, look, believe it or not, you have plenty of F minuses to go. Ace Wonder.
Okay.
So, you know, you got
good. I feel so better. Yeah. One in the chamber for later.
All right. So, Jamie Kennedy. This is this movie in a nutshell. Jamie Kennedy does his worst Jim Carrey impersonation as the Mask, which is bad. But then the rest of the time, when he's not doing a bad Jim Carrey impersonation, he's just playing Jamie Kennedy, which is also bad. It's like, this movie is like, all right, so you know when you watch like a cartoon movie, there's a 2D animated movie, and you go see it in the theaters, and you're like, oh, this shit was pretty good. And then they make a Saturday morning cartoon based on that movie you saw. This is that. This is what that movie is. This is the watered down fucking Saturday morning version of, like, if The Mask was like the big budget amazing thing, then this is like the watered down, like the voices is all wrong, and it's just super cringy.
So that's an insult to all Saturday morning cartoons.
Only good thing I can say about this movie is there are a lot of great actors and there's some cool comedians in it. You know, Alan Cummings, Bob Hoskins, Ben Stein, Cal Penn is in this movie, which I was surprised to see him. Steven Wright plays the boss. I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. But once you get past that, you know, and I actually enjoyed Alan Cumming in this movie as Loki, you know, for what his role called for him to be. Because I recognize this movie as, just like The Mask, as Monty had to tell me when we reviewed The Mask a couple months ago, is this movie is a cartoon. It is a live-action Saturday morning cartoon. So I watched it as if this was Freakazoid, or if this was The Tick, or if this was Animaniacs. And this is like all of those cartoons, if all of those cartoons had bad writers. And that's what this is. The whole, like, the movie just in and of itself has to just exist in a very low place when they do that whole "can't take my eyes off of you" dance scene.
Oh, like, God.
That shit was just bad and long, like prison rape. Like, it was just, you know, and then, like, you know, in the first movie, they established a certain rule with the movie. Like, this universe exists in a certain, that this movie exists in a certain universe. And the rule is that you can only use the mask at night. In the daytime, it doesn't work, but you can't use it at night. I mean, you can use it at night, but you can't use it in the daytime. Except in this movie, you can use it whatever the fuck you want. So, yeah, man, this movie is 10 kinds of bad. This is only for, like, parents with, like, very little kids, and nobody else is supposed to watch this. I gave this movie a D-, and the only reason I didn't give it an F is because of Alan Cumming and Bob Hoskins. And even then, I might be rethinking my grades. I'm in a D-, F range right now. I'm done.
All right.
I'm done.
Yeah, you're coming right in at time. Look at that. And let me reset before. Yeah,
I've been practicing. You know what I'm saying?
I see that. All right. Well, I'm going to be quick. I'm just going to start mine before I even start because I won't get all the way there. This movie, I will start by talking about how much I absolutely love the first Mask movie. Mm-hmm. I think that movie's great. I think that movie is fucking amazing. I recommend that movie to anybody. I think it's an awesome movie. Then this happens. And it looks like somebody just wrote down a bunch of different ideas for what you can do with the mask, spun them around in a lotto machine, and pulled them one by one. And then wherever they fell, that's the order that shit happened in this movie. This movie was such a fucking mess. I believed none of it. Like, we talked about Howard the Duck earlier, where the stupid shit could happen, and I believed it because they understood this crazy shit's gonna happen. We start the movie in Duck World. Because once we start in Duck World, you do whatever the fuck you want. Not whatever the fuck you want, but we got some room to play with. They weren't that self-aware. And unlike the first Mask, this movie took itself way too seriously. That's the problem with this Mask movie. It took itself way too seriously. Like when people would get possessed by Odin and we're still in this same tone, like, no, yeah. This is not happening. I don't believe it. Stop. Fucking stop. And when Jamie Kennedy got possessed by Odin, it made it all even worse. I was like, no, I'm done. I can't anymore. I've got nothing for it. F fucking minus. That's where I am with this. All right.
All right. Hold on. Write that shit down. Monty. That's right. F minus.
That's right.
Yep. Me and Daryl are synced up on this episode.
We in tonight, man.
Yeah. All right. So I'm gonna throw a little bit of curveball here. First of all, I love the original Mask. Two, yeah. I watched the Saturday morning fucking cartoons. And that shit was awesome. And so, if we're gonna talk about this movie, let's talk about the three different fucking movies there was. Cause that's what it was. I like the dog and the baby shit. It reminded me of an extended version of what you would see with, if you ever remember Animaniacs with Mindy and Buttons, that was this shit. Those scenes were fucking awesome. What the dog would do to the baby and the baby would come back and do it to the dog. That shit deserves a B. The way the fucking baby, if this was a nightmare cartoon with the baby terrorizing his daddy, that shit was fucking awesome. Because if you've ever had a small kid, you really start to think, this motherfucker is really trying to drive me motherfucking insane.
Yeah, watching this movie definitely didn't make me want to have kids, like, for sure.
That shit was fucking awesome. And if it was a serious movie where Loki was sincerely trying to rescue a small fucking item that can cause the destruction of the world, and Odin was breathing down his back, I can relate to that shit because I know Norse mythology. Fucking Loki is actually awesome in Norse mythology. People know him as a trickster god, but he's also the motherfucking god of heroic deeds. He gets into shit. But the fact that they try to throw this shit together in one movie made the whole, like, when you get invested in one part, it switched to something else. And this shit, I won't give it an F. I will give it a D, maybe D minus. But it's a fact that if they wanted to keep it, like Monty said, if they weren't doing movies by Mad Libs, this would have been so much of a better movie. But the fact that they try to throw, like, hey, we get some sugar over here, some flour over here, some motherfucking gravy over here. Stop this shit and make a fucking consistent movie with a consistent tone. I bet no one considered the tone or the fucking theme of the movie. This is the reason why the Nostalgia Critic came up with the whole thing. A family picture. Because that's the pitch. We're going to make a family picture. And it was for nobody. I'm done.
Yeah. They make a lot of these movies where they're like kids movies, like these kids family movies that are like real slapsticky and just kind of like those movies like Baby's Day Out and shit like that. And you'd be like, they're not good movies, you know what I'm saying?
It feels like they throw these movies together like, yeah, they're just kids, they won't care. Give them a baby peeing in their face. They'll be okay. You know, they'll laugh at it. A little fart humor.
And see, I got something against that shit. Quite literally. When Winter Soldier came out, my daughter was fucking 5 years old.
Okay.
And quite literally, if you haven't seen the movie, I know spoiler alerts, but in the scene where fucking Nick Fury dies, a fucking 5-year-old can say, hey, he's not really dead, is he? That's what cemented me with making sure that my motherfucking daughter goes to every Marvel movie that I can take her to. Because they know the new Marvel movies are for kids, but they don't treat them as a fucking stupid. This motherfucking movie right here tried to treat people like they were stupid. It's the fact is, if I can cut the motherfucking movie up to where it's just continuous scene after continuous scene, it would be so much of a better movie. But the fact that they try to blend this shit in, fuck them.
Yeah.
And I've always said before, because I know some parents that have kids that get mad at me for grading kids movies as aggressively as I do.
Yeah.
And they always be like, well, you know, you can't grade it like it's a regular movie. You got to grade it on the scale of it's a kids movie. So you got to grade it next to other kids movies. And I'm like, so even if I was grading it next to other kids movies, I would be grading it next to Pixar movies, which are all A+ Oscar nominated, Oscar winning movies. There's a way where you can make a movie for children that doesn't pander to the lowest common denominator. Now, I'm not mad that movies like this exist because there's a market for them. There's somebody out there that likes these dumbass movies. Otherwise, they wouldn't keep making these dumbass movies. This is a dumbass movie. When y'all were watching this movie, what moments made you laugh when you watched this?
I don't think I laughed at all.
I'm not gonna lie. Every time the baby would do some shit to where Jamie Kennedy seemed like he was going insane. This shit made me laugh crazily. Where he's like, he's trying to make you go insane, and then you pan over and you see the shit, and the baby whispered in his ear. And he just drops the motherfucking kid. It's like, what the fuck is going on? That shit made me laugh.
The only reason that didn't work for me was because they showed Michigan J. Frog before it, which I'm fine with, because we all know that's what that's inspired by.
Right.
But when you set that up, you have to step it up a step. You have to go one step beyond that. And they didn't. They did the exact same thing. Like, you just showed me the joke and then redid the joke. It's like a guy standing in front of you going, remember that scene in this movie where they did this? But the only difference is we just saw him doing that. And then this guy 5 minutes later says, remember when they did this in this movie? Like, yeah, I saw it, baby. Stop. That was my problem with it.
I think my thing, like, Jamie Kennedy was so unlikable, man, that I think within the first 5 or 10 minutes of the movie, I was already in F-minus territory. So the rest of the movie didn't even really get a chance to connect.
Was unlikable or is unlikable?
Oh, is. I'm sorry. Yeah. But thank you.
Jamie Kennedy for me is like, there's certain actors that as soon as I see their names in movies, I just like, I'm instantly dialed out. Jamie Kennedy is one of those actors. Like whenever, if I'm doing a fantasy casting of a movie and I'm like, man, who could I cast to make no one want to watch this movie? Kennedy's name always pops up for me. He's one of those guys. You know, make Jamie Kennedy like Katherine Heigl's best friend in the movie, and I would guarantee nobody watches that movie.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
Who's Hannibal the Cannibal?
Yeah. Yeah, man. The shit is trash. All right, what's the next movie, Monty? I see what it is.
Yep. It's about to be fantastic for the rest of the show. We are going to July 8th, 2005, for Fantastic Four, and that starts off with Hannibal. After you give your five facts, tell Joey man, when to start your time.
This almost should be a What's Eating Hannibal, man, because there's so much. Okay, but let's see. All right, five quick facts about this. I might not do five. I might just give y'all a couple. Okay, so one of the facts, and I told this to Monty earlier, but the screenplay for this movie got extensively rewritten because they didn't want this movie to look or be anything like Pixar's The Incredibles. So The Incredibles came out first and did gangbusters at the movie theaters. And they were like, oh, shit, we don't want our movie to look like that. So they rewrote this movie to be the movie that we have now.
Wait, what?
Yes.
Quite literally, The Incredibles are ripping off the fence.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Hugh Jackman was offered the role of Reed Richards, and there's a deleted scene where Reed Richards actually uses his rubber stretching abilities to turn into Wolverine. It got deleted out the movie. Stan Lee said that Michael Chiklis's performance as The Thing, and I think they asked him this in 2012, so I don't know where it would stand now. But in 2012, Stan Lee was asked about the movie, and he said Michael Chiklis' Thing performance was his favorite performance of any Marvel film, period. He said that he thought it was very true to the comic, and Michael Chiklis lobbied to get the role to play The Thing. During the development, Chris Columbus pushed for the film to have a heavy comedic tone along the lines of the old Batman TV series, like the 1966 Adam West Batman movies. And despite being hired because of his comedic background, Tim Story was able to persuade Columbus that doing an outright comedic tone would be a disaster for this movie, and that they ought to do something that kind of blurred the lines more along the line of Sam Raimi's Spider-Man. And Tim Story got the right to direct these movies because they like how he did the Barbershop movies. So somebody at Fox saw the Barbershop movies and was like, that guy right there, we need that guy to direct the Fantastic Four movies.
Yikes.
Yes. So just know. I've only seen the first Barbershop movie. I was like, this shit is terrible. I can't even fucking just do this shit. Okay, start my time, Monty.
Here we go.
I'm not even going to have enough time to say all the shit that I want to say about this movie, man. I'm going to run out of time. All right.
Sit back and watch. This
is yeah, I'm about to train wreck this shit, man. This movie is a shitty remake of Sam Raimi's first Spider-Man movie mixed with the shitty Green Lantern movie. Honest Trailers described it as a movie about a space cloud giving people completely different powers in one movie and then having to recreate that space cloud on Earth to get rid of the powers. And then in the sequel, a different space cloud tries to destroy the Earth while also trying to fight Victor the Green Goblin, Von Doom, and the Silver T-1000 Morpheus. That's the best way to describe the two movies that we're about to talk about. There's two good things I can say about the first Fantastic Four movie. Chris Evans as Johnny Storm and elements of Michael Chiklis as The Thing, they do a pretty good job as Ben Grimm and John and Human Torch. And the Ben Grimm hospital fake out scene is funny as hell, because we already know he's about to turn to the thing. He looks in the mirror and he thinks he's about to be fucked up and nothing happens. Those two. That's it. That is everything good I can say about this fucking movie. Okay? That is everything positive I can say about this movie. When the Human Torch first appears in the movie, he's kissing this girl while he's riding his motorcycle, right? And then we see, they zoom out and we see Mr. Fantastic, we see Reed and Ben standing on this tower with binoculars. And it was like, why were they standing there with binoculars? Were they standing there because they were waiting to see John Storm pull up on a motorcycle? You know what I'm saying?
Right.
That shit was weird. It was like they just cut from, like, they were just talking about going to space, and then all of a sudden they were just in space. You know what I'm saying? That was just shit that happened. They cut to a scene of Victor at a boardroom meeting, you know, where he told his stock, he was told that his stock is plummeting and that he has a week to fix it. But why is his stock plummeting? I mean, we presume it has something to do with the space mission, but they don't specifically talk about how those things are related. It was just like, oh, you went to space and now your stock is bad. It's just, and the movie just does a lot of that throughout the movie. John, Human Torch tells his nurse he wants to snowboard down the side of a mountain. I have enough time. He said he decides he wants to snowboard down the side of a mountain, and his nurse, who also happens to be an extreme skier, you know, right. it just was like, yeah, I'll go with you down the side of a mountain. Like, what are the odds of that happening? Like, what exactly are the odds of that shit happening? There's a lot of terrible shit in this movie that I don't have enough time to get to. I gave this movie a D. I might give it a D. I have so much to just vent about this fucking movie. There's not enough time. There's just not enough time.
There's not. All right. Well, it comes over to me. Just what grade did you give it, Hannibal? I'm curious.
I'm in a D minus range.
All right. Well, we'll see if I'm popular or unpopular with mine. So, Mike, I'm sorry. Zoe, start me. Go ahead and start my time. I probably won't need it all. Hannibal hit a lot of it. So hit play.
Yeah.
Go. He hit a lot of what I was thinking. There was so much, like, one of my biggest problems was I had to rewind the movie when all of a sudden we were in space. That was the first thing that threw me off, because I'm watching the movie and then I see a shit happening and I see the door open and we're in space. And I'm like, did I look away? Did I miss something? And no, the fuck I didn't. I missed nothing. They just were all of a sudden in space. Nothing established that we were in space. We're just there. Like, space, the final frontier. Like it's Star Trek, and we've been watching all these years. Fuck y'all for that. That's... you don't know how to tell a fucking story. And before that, I was already iffy on the whole story, because things just didn't work. I just didn't understand why... Throughout this entire movie, I didn't understand why we were doing anything. Why is any of this happening? Why is he mad? Why is the Fantastic Four? That Stanley cameo, awesome. Other than that was about the only good thing about this movie. This movie was bullshit. This movie made no goddamn sense. And to the point where I'm nitpicky about shit, and I hate being nitpicky about movies, but the movie itself was so bullshit, I had to find something to entertain myself with. And that entertainment came from Ben Grimm's wife, this crazy bitch, with, you know, you can't even pretend to be like, oh, you're covered in orange rocks. We'll see if it'll work. She should, or, you know, maybe I'll give her props for just being straightforward. Like, nah, nigga. Sorry.
How does it feel that the blind chick was the one that was after his ass?
Yeah.
But she definitely felt his ass up. Like, oh, let me see.
Yeah. Yeah. And then the ring on the bridge, like, really? That's what you're going to do? You just watch them save everybody. And you were going to walk to the bridge. this heartless fucking bitch decided to go to the bridge and go, you know what? I'm giving this motherfucker his ring back on the bridge. That's what you get for turning into Orange Rock without telling me. What? No, no. F fucking minus on Fantastic Four.
Is it a problem if you stay hard for more than 4 hours?
Yes. Yes. F fucking minus on this movie. That's what it got from me.
All right. Yeah. And look, there's so much, like, bro, the movie is so bad. It is such a bad fucking movie, man. Like, you know, this nigga, like the thing's wife comes outside, like he's like, "Hey, baby, come outside. I need to talk to you." And she was like, "All right." And then she comes outside in her lingerie in New York at night. Nigga, what? Please.
They was under quarantine, you know. Maybe you know she wanted to get that beef. Yeah. Fresh from outer space.
She was going to get something solid as a rock is what she was going to get anyway. Crimson, where are you, sir?
Look, Thing should have called her up and said, "Hey, I'm home and I'm rock hard."
All right. See, that's what they missed out on. They should have did a whole bunch of, like, Thing, like sexual supplement pills. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you know what? The sad part about it is they made a lot of jokes about Reed being limp.
Yeah.
They did.
All right, so this is going to be unpopular. This is going to be unpopular, but I gave it a C-. This is the reason why I gave it a C-. The character motherfucking relationships. The fact that Doom was jealous of Reed, even though he had shit, that was what made him arrogant. That's what started the shit. The fact that Reed was so caught up in motherfucking science that when old girl came out in a tight motherfucking suit, he's looking at the suit instead of her assets. The fact that Ben and Johnny are like two motherfucking brothers that hate each other but can't fucking stand to be without each other. The fact that the guy who played fucking Doom in this is who I think of when I think of Doom. Arrogant, ready for a fall, and just his own worst fucking enemy. And I hate the fact that in both of the origin stories, they say the same fucking line. "Susan, where are you? Don't fucking talk to somebody that you fight that's invisible." Throw a lot of fucking power out. But other than that, it does have some stupid ass scenes. I hate the scenes where you have to get fucking Jessica Alba or whatever her name is naked. Just for the fact that you want to see her in a bra.
They actually added those scenes to the movie after they cast Jessica Alba.
That's stupid to me. Secondly, I like Ben Grimm, Chitlis' performance. He is actually great in this, and I think this is the reason why he got that show, No Ordinary Family, on ABC.
Mm-hmm.
I like the guy who plays Doom because he's always been my favorite from Charmed when he was playing Balthazar.
Okay.
And Chris Evans in this movie, he reminds me of Johnny Storms, and this is the depth of his character that he plays. He is actively like a fucking hotshot pilot that has skated away with getting away with so much shit. And the scene where he's like, "Oh, Rick, you want to see something new? This is something new." When you see those eyes turn on, that was an awesome fucking scene. Now, the end was left to be desired, but it was an awesome fucking scene. And I just love when Johnny fight. That was awesome.
All right. So what'd you give it? What was your grade again?
He gave it a C-.
C-. All right.
C-.
It's the characters. And whenever you get a good character, the script can be shitty, but if you can get characters to relate to each other well, it bumps up my expectation for a movie.
Okay. All right. Hey, in recognition of your humanitarian contributions, we, the people of Latveria, give you this creepy mask.
Maybe
that was a thing that happened in the movie. The way Dr. Doom got his mask was it was in recognition of his humanitarian contributions. They gave him the, could you imagine me like the NAACP saying, Hannibal, you've done so much for black people, we gave you this fucked up clown mask.
Yeah, right. But you would take that shit and be like, yeah.
But, okay, right, fair. But say they gave it to Daryl, Ace Wonder. They gave it to you. They gave it to Crimson. Like, what the fuck, man? What is... All right,
I would probably just give that mask to you.
Yes. Wait, you're talking about the mask where he is building a quite literally 30-foot God statue in front of his building everybody has to walk by and worship every day.
Oh, look, listen. And that's one of the things about the movie that's just dumb as hell to me, because it's like, As soon as the movie starts, they're building this giant statue of him in the middle of this plaza. They're welding the statue. There's no safety bars. There's no rope. There's nothing. They're just shooting fucking sparks out, just falling down while people are just walking back and forth through the lobby. You know why that happens in the movie? You know why? Bad writing.
No, that happens this is the enemy. This is who's going to get him fighting at the end.
Yeah.
God, King, Doom, quite literally.
Yeah, and they've done that in other movies, too, that just wasn't written that bad.
I can just start there. You can start my time at bad writing. And we could just go from there. Because at the very beginning of the movie, you already mentioned the statue that was getting built. And outside of the fact that this dude's name is Victor Von Doom, and they couldn't figure out who the bad guy was going to be. Like, I think that was some of my biggest problem with the movie, was that one, that it was poorly put together in a way that they didn't really explain how anything happened. And then I forgot what my second point was. Damn. They didn't explain how anything happened. And then the things that they did explain, they made it like childishly obvious what was going on.
Yeah.
Character wise, there were some characters I liked. Like I said, I did like The Thing. I liked Human Torch. But I didn't like Jessica Alba, you know, as the Invisible Woman. And I didn't like Reed Richards.
You didn't like Eowyn Horde?
Yeah, I'm looking at his name right here, man. And I tried to avoid it. I think I was going to keep it wrong. But, I liked, what's the dude from Nip Tuck? The dude who was Dr. Doom. I liked him, but I felt like the shit was put together so badly that kind of ruined it for him too.
Yeah.
So yeah, in the end, I gave it a D.
All right.
I gave it a D. I didn't go as far to give it an F because we also ended up watching more Fantastic Four movies after that. So I ended up kind of having to go back and take that movie out of F territory afterwards.
Wait. It's a Fantastic Four movie and it's a Fan Four Stick movie.
Yeah, that is true. I just like to just point out the Ben Grimm bridge paradox for a moment. All right. Ben Grimm, after his wife Andrea from Walking Dead, who, like, shout out to them casting. Like, I don't know if this chick just be like, hey, what's the most despicable role you could have for a white woman in a movie? Like, what's a role for a white woman where everybody's going to hate her? And then she'd be like, and she just always signs up for them because she's hateable in Walking Dead. And she found a way to be hateable in this shit. This shit's amazing. But, like, Ben Grimm is on the bridge and a dude is about to try to kill himself, right? The dude that's trying to
kill himself. Give me 1 second. Hold that thought. Remember where you were. Yeah. Lusty McButt said, and I want to catch these before they go away. She said, off topic, but how many times do people need to tell G-Man Hannibal and Monty made the audacity vid before he believes it? Plunger points for that, 25. And Ian Dubois says, this isn't an episode of The Shit Show. This is Hannibal and Monty Comic Theater 3000. 25 plunger points for that, too.
Yeah.
Hannibal continues.
Yes. So, for everybody who's seen this movie, let's talk about the Ben Grimm bridge paradox, right? Like, the thing, his wife he just finds out that his wife doesn't want to have anything to do with him. He's all ugly and covered in rot. First off, the nigga look like a rotten pumpkin. Let's start there, okay? The nigga look like bad food, okay? Then he's sitting on the bridge. He's sitting on the Brooklyn Bridge, and then this dude walks up to kill himself, sees Ben Grimm sitting there as the Thing, and then it's like, oh shit, he falls into oncoming traffic, and then Ben Grimm jumps down to save him, right? And this causes all the commotion that causes all the accidents and stops all the traffic on the bridge. Here's my thing. This is the Brooklyn fucking bridge. How the fuck did Ben Grimm even get up there without anybody seeing him? You see what? All the commotion that happened when they saw him in passing by accident. You know what I'm saying? How the fuck did he even get up there without causing all the catastrophe? Like, what are the odds? Seriously, what are the odds of Ben Grimm getting up there? Then Johnny Storm, Sue Storm, and Reed Richards are all in the cab looking for the Thing. And he happens to be on the bridge that they're on while they're looking for him. Yep. What are the odds? Seriously, what are the odds of that shit being true? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Then, like, the truck, the 18-wheel truck is about to hit the fucking guy, and then Ben Grimm shoulder rams the truck. First off, he definitely killed that guy. that guy definitely died, okay? I know the movie didn't show him die because it's PG and shit, but that guy, in any other scenario, he fucking died because Ben Grimm folded that truck in half, right?
Yeah. Right.
Then the truck explodes, and then Johnny Storm is able to fucking cover up the little girl, and then the ball of flame, like, engulfs the two of them, but they're okay. First off, nigga, that's not how fire works, okay? Like, that bitch is dead, okay? That little girl is gone. I'm sorry. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? You just protected her body, but she's dead. Like, if the fire didn't kill her, the smoke for sure killed that bitch, all right?
Well, better yet, the heat from the fucking on-fire air would have burnt her lungs.
Then, like, I could rant about how terrible that scene is for a while. But then at the end of it, the cops all got guns on Ben Grimm. First off, shout out to the cops for just seeing him and just start shooting without even asking him to freeze. All right? Shout out
to police. That's what they do us.
That's the most realistic shit there is.
Yeah. Shout out to movies being realistic about their perception of the cops, right? But then the cops after the Fantastic Four save everybody, right? The cops all put their guns on Ben Grimm, like, put your hands up right now, get up, doing all that shit, and then a bunch of people just start applauding, and the cops let them go. So you mean to tell me if I get a bunch of white people to just clap when the police is around, I can get out of a jam? I call Bubba the Dash.
Wait. Remember, the cops had already shot at his ass.
Yes.
And the shit had bounced off and caused the fucking fire.
Yes.
And still, we're going to put more guns on him.
Yes.
Motherfucker, it didn't work the first time.
And then Andrea from Walking Dead, a.k.a. Debbie, a.k.a. Ben Grimm's motherfucking wife, somehow gets her ass on the Brooklyn Bridge where he is, and there's a mountain of traffic and a mountain of people and cops and police and it's all types of shit. Some kind of way, this bitch cuts her way all the way to the front of the line so she can give this nigga back his ring.
I'm telling you, that's my problem with that woman. She sat at home. She was pissed off. She's like, this motherfucker is on the news being orange. Yeah. Oh, I'm getting to that fucking bridge. Like, this nigga wants to be orange and rocks while I'm supposed to be his fiance. Fuck him. Fuck him. And she gets to the bridge and she's like, you know what? Hey, fuck you.
Yeah.
Here's your fucking ring. That's what you get for being orange and made a rock, motherfucker.
Yeah, like, what? She straight hit him with the U-G-E-L-Y. You ain't got no alibi. You ugly.
But not only that, she went home and got mad and stewed about that shit for a good long while and then went to that bridge to let him know this how ugly you are.
Yeah.
Here's your ring.
All right. So here's my thing about this movie that I fucking hate about a lot of comic book movies. They try to throw in the fuck. I got happy when I saw this motherfucker take that action figure when it was like, it's covering time, took it and smashed it against the wall. Because I hate them throwing in motherfucking catchphrases for no fucking reason.
Yeah.
Flame on. No, don't do that shit. It's clobbering. Like, when he delivered it to Doom, that was actually awesome.
But the other times, oh, we're going to throw in a catchphrase just to throw in it. Like, no.
Yeah, that shit is true. Look, Ben, at the end of the movie, Ben Grimm voluntarily, like, turns, like, they find a way to make him not be the Thing anymore. And then he voluntarily turns himself back into the Thing. You know what I'm saying? Like, why did he do that? Because of friendship? Because of obligation? You know what I'm saying? Like, the whole movie, he has hated being the Thing. And now I'm supposed to believe that because Doom was kicking Reed Richards' ass, that he decided that a lifetime of ridicule was worth it. First off, Reed Richards ain't got no bones. He's not even really hurt right now, okay? You know what I'm saying? Let him take that ass whooping, and then you got your dick back, and you can go get your ratchet-ass bitch back. You know what I'm saying? And then the movie ends with us seeing Dr. Doom in a shipping container being shipped back to Latveria. You see his assistant Leonard signing off on him going back to Latveria. Except the boat was already at sea, bitch. He was already going out there. The boat was already going there. There was like 45 shipping containers. So what happens if he doesn't sign off on the container? Are they going to turn the ship around and go back to... Nah, this movie's awful, bro.
Yeah. All right.
It was a lot of telling, not showing. If they would have fixed that up just a little bit better, it would have been a better movie.
Just trash, bro.
All right. Well, let's hit the next one.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, no, there we go. 2 years. This only happened 2 years later. June 15th, 2007.
Yeah.
We get Fantastic Four, Rise of the Silver Surfer. Boy, you got anything for this?
Yeah, I do. Tim Story, the director, refused to put giant robots in any of his movies. So because of that, he made the conscious decision to make Galactus, because Galactus looks like a robot to him, he decided to make Galactus a giant space cloud instead, because he refused to have giant robots in any of his movies.
Wow.
Yeah, he just decided that. He was like, you know. There's a dialogue in the movie when Reed Richards says that he is engaged to the hottest woman on the planet, pointing to Susan Storm, played by Jessica Alba. This was a reference to the fact that Jessica Alba had just been declared Time Magazine's sexiest female alive. Jessica Alba also, upon receiving criticism of her performance in this film, director Tim Story told her that in one or two of the scenes where she's crying, he was like, you know what? It looks too real. You're acting too good in this shit. I need you to be more vanilla. I don't need all that flavoring in your performance. I need that shit to look a lot more basic. And he literally told her to be as bland as possible with her facial expressions, because, and he's like, yeah, and we can just CGI the tears in later.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, God. I got to get a drink for that shit.
Yeah.
Yes. Get your drink, I think. Or actually, Crimson was next.
Yeah, and one more tidbit of information. In 1980, Lee Kramer wanted to make a Silver Surfer rock opera performed by Paul McCartney, starring Olivia Newton-John.
Wow.
Yeah, and like, they apparently it was written and everything, and they were going to do it, and it was just like at the end, it was like, nah, we can't do this.
Yeah, no, they can't. They can't. They should not do that.
Yeah.
So, all right, well, let's start the time. Crimson, I think we're back on you. Wait, is that where we were? Wait, it was me?
No, I thought it was you, Monty.
Who went first last time?
You did.
Hey. I went first last time. Monty, yes, it's you.
Good. Oh, so it's me.
I get to go last this time. Awesome. Yeah. Let me get my thoughts together. Let me get my rates right.
All right, so it is me. I'm glad we figured that out. So, yeah, you can start my time whenever. It's fine. So, Rise of the Silver Surfer. This movie, and I guess, because I'm not going to go through, I'm not going to need all the time. I'll start with the reason why this is a fucking torture episode. One of the reasons. Because I swore I would never watch these fucking movies. I knew when we started doing the Ultimate Comic Book Movie List, eventually I would have to. And I have gone this long without seeing either one of these movies. And I wish I hadn't seen them, either one of them, which both movies are terrible. Rise of the Silver Surfer, to me, is slightly better than the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not based on visuals or anything like that. It's they told the story a little better up until the point that Victor fucking Von Doom comes back. Because right. why did any of that shit even happen to him? Nothing was lasting. He's back to being the same guy he was before. I don't understand what y'all are trying to do or were trying to do with these movies. Nothing made sense. Everything was so fucking random and out of place. This had a little more structure. At least we knew that Silver Surfer's toxic fart was coming to eat the planet. We had no idea why. We had no idea what the fuck it was. None of that made sense. But his board was the thing we needed to stop Galactus. That's all we got. I don't know how that's enough. This movie was... Yeah, this movie was also fucking bullshit. Not as bad as the first Fantastic Four. I give it a D. Flat out D.
All right.
So, there we go. So, that's all I got. Crimson, it's on you.
All right. So, watching Fantastic Four, two weddings and a dance party. So, here's the thing. If they would have came out with the fucking Rise of the Silver Surfer, if they would have came out with truly showcasing that power of cosmic instead of a game of musical chair powers,
right?
This would have been a better movie. Absolutely. But I think they're running away from it being a comic book movie, because when you saw the Silver Surfer come in and do amazing shit, the whole scene where he's CGI'ing through a fucking building, that shit looked awesome. Yeah. I would even say the fight with fucking Doom in the end was awesome. And I get the whole there's no consequence to his actions, but the guy who was playing Doom is eating the motherfucking scenery. Quite literally, he says, "You can't do shit without me." This is after, like, Reed has had his big speech. He's like, "Y'all failed." Like, "Ha ha, we brought Doom." And he comes in and literally is like, "Well, you know he's going to betray you in the end. I got him on a short lease." What does he do? Betrays him in the motherfucking end. This would have been a great movie if they wouldn't have ran away from the fucking comic book aspect of it. But the fact is, we need to be serious. We can't be a comic book. Let Marvel make this shit now. Let Marvel make this shit now. You're going to see the Silver Surfer coming in, be like, "Up, you inside out. Up, you can't talk. Up, and here is motherfucking Galactus. Galactus is going to come in and it's like, hey, I'm trying to eat. You puny humans, fuck you. I'm trying to eat." This would be an awesome movie if they didn't run away from the fact that this is not Reed and Sue's wedding adventure. No, this is supposed to be the fucking Fantastic Four. Now, in this one, Chris Evans lost a little bit to me in this movie, because it was just like they took away from his Johnny Stormness to cater to a wedding. Fuck that. I do like they had Fantastic Four car. That shit was an awesome ass vehicle. Maybe that's nostalgia from the early TV show, the cartoon TV show. But I give it a D.
All right. D. All right. Fair enough. We're equal on those grades. There we go.
Vapion said, according to my search, there's over 2,000 bridges of different sizes in New York. So if there's 2,000, that would be a 0.05% chance that Reed, Sue, and Johnny would have been on the same bridge as Ben.
Quite literally, they have a movie called 21 Bridges coming out.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Right. Yes. I got his 100 points written down.
All right. Give him some extra for me. I'm gonna give him 10.
Okay. I was giving him 20.
All right, there we go. He's got 30 altogether. Look, Vapion just scored. So
that puts him at the high man today. He's got 47.
All right. On top of Zoe's been adding them as we go, I think.
I was gonna just email them to you at the end of the show.
Email them after. Like, some of y'all will see your plunger points grow during the show. But that being said, it's on to Ace Wonder with his grades or his thoughts.
Well, on Rise of the Silver Surfer.
This one was more the same for me, honestly, from the first one. I do see where it was a little bit better done, but it still kind of trudged on the same way for me. And I think a big part of the disappointment was in the Silver Surfer character himself. I couldn't wrap my head around it the whole movie, how the Fantastic Four could even fight him.
Yeah.
You know, like, knowing what I know about the Silver Surfer, that shouldn't have even been a thing. That should have been like a 5-second fight for him. You know, so like the entire time I'm kind of in that. I don't get like that often around comic books, but you know, I was in that space watching it, it kind of aggravated me throughout. Like the wedding stuff, I really wasn't feeling too much. Although I was happy to see, you know, like Stan Lee's camp, you know, Stan Lee at the wedding. I thought that was kind of cool. But I really don't have anything positive to say about this movie. Dr. Doom coming back, I kind of had the opposite effect for me this time that it had in the first movie. I kind of liked him in the first movie. And when he showed up in this movie, again, that's kind of around the time where things really just got out of control for me. And like I said, and I wasn't aware that Silver Surfer was so powerless without his board. Like,
according to this movie.
Yeah, exactly.
I wasn't feeling that, man. I gave it a D+ because it was slightly better than the first one, but basically it was just more the same.
Yeah. So first thing first, I say this all the time. Sometimes there's scenes in a movie that are so bad that it drops the whole movie a letter grade, and this movie has a bunch of those scenes. But let me start with the positives first. The Human Torch chasing Silver Surfer scene is awesome. That is a great scene. Good job for them for that. And the Stan Lee cameo. This is actually my favorite Stan Lee cameo. This one and the Amazing Spider-Man. Those are my two favorite Stan Lee cameos of all the Marvel Cinematic cameos that he's done. Okay, now let's get into the bad. First things first. The bachelor party scene. I fart on that whole scene. I farted. That scene is trash. And I want to get into the pulses, tachyon pulse thing, and Reed's speech to the general. I want to talk about all that shit, but because I only got like 2 minutes to talk, let me start with the Siberian installation scene. Okay, the army decides to detain the Fantastic Four while they torture the Surfer. Right then, Invisible Girl, who is known to have the ability to turn invisible, right? It's like they're detained, and then Johnny Storm distracts the one guard in this Siberian installation and says, "Hey, we got nothing to do. He will find us some DVDs." And the one guard who knows that they have somebody who has the ability to turn invisible is like, "Yeah, I'm gonna leave and go get you some DVDs."
Power people,
right? Then in that same moment, General Haig, who is talking to the doctor who's torturing Silver Surfer, is like, "Hey, I got called away. I got called away. So let's all leave this room where we're torturing the Silver Surfer and go do some other shit right now." You know what I'm saying? So that Sue Storm can walk in here and talk to the Surfer. Surfer is like, "Hey, I can tell somebody's here. You invisible, but I know you can turn invisible." You know what I'm saying? So first off, while she's talking to the Silver Surfer, he's like, "Hey, I can tell somebody's here." She automatically just becomes visible again. Why? Why would you do that? They got to have cameras in this room, right? Because you're watching the Silver Surfer, right? So somebody's watching the cameras to see if somebody pops in there, right? Wrong. Because it's bad writing. And why does this nigga Silver Surfer six-pack also a DVD player? Because he showed the whole documentary of Galactus destroying empires on his stomach. All right? And why? I told you, it's not enough time to do all this shit. Okay, I'm gonna just end it with this. And this is why the movie gets a low D for me. Riddle me this. Galactus gave Silver Surfer his power and made him a slave. Why would you also give your slave the power to kill you?
Okay. Okay. I'm going to jump on that. The fact that they threw fucking Frankie, his other hero from fucking Earth, to just be a motherfucking side character, that shit was stupid.
Yeah. Oh no, that was. But, and look, I give passes to that because I know that when they there's a certain amount of fan service they want to do on these movies. So when I saw Frankie, I was like, "Ain't she somebody?" I had to Google it just to make sure. It's like, yeah, I was like, "Ain't she somebody? Why is she just, you know?" But when they do stuff like that, I give it a pass. But like, if you're gonna tell me this story, you're gonna create this story from scratch, you know, or based on like loosely based on the source material, you gotta at least make it make sense. You know what I'm saying? Like Galactus is this all-powerful being that eats planets. You know what I'm saying? Which, and the planet eating doesn't even make any sense because what the fuck is up with all the holes in the planet? Does he need all those holes in the planet in order to be able to eat the planet? Because when they were in Germany, Silver Surfer never made the hole. You know what I'm saying? So what happens if the hole doesn't get made? Can Galactus...
Something happened. Hang on. We lost Hannibal's audio. Yeah, his audio's gone.
Did he drop out altogether?
No, he's still there. He's still there and talking. I hear y'all. It's on his end. But I will I'll use that opportunity to move into wait. Something's happening. Wait, there's some audio coming in. See, the fucking Fantastic Four ruined the shit for him.
Ugh. I would say this.
What's that?
About the whole, what is awesome about Galactus, he's not supposed to be motherfucking stopped. And they built up this whole thing about fucking Reed being the smartest person in the world. He didn't beat Galactus because he used some kind of big motherfucking hammer to beat his ass. He beat his ass off of intelligence.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that, like I said with the Hulk, you took one of the best aspects of Reed and just says, hey, window dressing, this is Reed.
Yeah.
Right. But and that's something else. Like in both of these movies, if you really think about it, he didn't come off as that smart.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And wait, hang on. Thrift Store Dan, 10 plunger points. No, I'm gonna do 5. That's just a joke, but it's a funny as fuck joke. Thrift Store Dan says, Hannibal, we don't know what you're saying. That's a good one. That's good shit. Oh, I heard him laugh. Wait. That's good shit. You came in and went out.
Am I back? Am I going?
You're back. I'm back. All right. Let's hit this other movie. Wait, let me get to my date. There we go. And we are reaching the tail end of our torture episode.
Oh no, this is it. This is
the movie. This is from August 7th, 2015. So, Fantastic Four, the remake, or I guess it's a remake.
The reboot.
The third try at Fantastic Four, basically. Hannibal, you got facts about this one for us before we pass it on? Oh. I think we lost him again. We can't hear you. Whatever happened again.
Besides this movie being only made so Fox can keep the rights?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Well, look.
The best thing about this movie was that it was only 90 minutes.
Yeah. While Hannibal fixes his audio, we'll let Crimson take your 3 minutes.
Yes, all right. So, nobody in this movie looked fucking good at all. After Chronicle, Michael B. Jordan tried to do this movie, and it was shitty. Again, we had this horrible thing of trying to make motherfucking lines work from the comics. Nope. From the comics. Gotcha.
Okay, cool. I'm back. And I'm back.
From the it's clobbering time to the, again, why does Doom always like to play peekaboo with Susan? Right. I'm just saying. And yeah. The whole in the beginning, Victor Von Doom, Dr. Doom here. No, You could have just not left it as Dr. Doom. You could have had it as some other body. The fact of the matter is, this was shit. Reading this motherfucker, we think that he was stupid in the other ones. He was just imbecilic. They took every ounce of personality from Ben Grimm. They took every ounce of personality from Johnny Storm. It's okay to be a pompous asshole. But when you're a pompous asshole with no fucking character, you're me. And I'm not a good character in a motherfucking movie. And I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Sue Storm does not have to be a super intelligent woman in order to be a strong woman. I'm pretty sure that even in the comics, Sue Storm is not a fucking scientist. But God damn it, she stood up against three fucking Celestials. She is a quintessential strong-ass motherfucker. She doesn't have to play super scientist sidekick to Reed. And I hate they took away from her character to make her that. Instead of just being like, she, what was she in that movie? Sidekick.
Yeah.
She played sidekick. And I mean, like, it was just all around like the snivy little like Dr. Doom, super hard PETA person, whatever the fuck. Like, dude, like, no. Dr. Doom is not concerned with saving the world. Doom is Doom!
Yeah.
And you had him turn into a whiny little emo bitch. Excuse me. Yeah, whiny little email dog.
Yeah. There you go. No, that's fine. We don't want to insult G-Man, so... You know,
we don't want real bitches getting mad at us.
So. Yeah. Yeah. So there we go. What grade did you give it before we?
F minus.
Ooh.
F minus. Just so it can keep a right, it gets a fucking F. It reminds me of those Hellraiser movies that they look like they shot with like a regular camcorder just to keep rights. F minus. You should have left Marvel get that movie back. Damn. We could have Franklin Richards by goddamn it right now.
All right. We don't agree on this one, but we'll see when we get to me. But we'll pass it on. Damn, that's harsh. Oh. You cut that one deep. All right. We'll pass it on to Ace Wonder. Wait, what were you gonna say, Hannibal?
No, I think it's interesting because he watched all three Fantastic Four movies and felt like this was the worst of the three.
Yeah. Yeah. That is interesting.
So all right. If he hadn't watched them and was going based off of memory, I'd be like, okay, it's one thing. But he sat down and watched all three of them. Yeah. So he is resolute in this F minus.
No, that's fair. All right. We're going to pass it over to Daryl. Let's see. Ace Wonder. I keep doing that shit. All right. Take it.
What can I say about this movie that hasn't been said about Afghanistan?
At least in Afghanistan, you get great drugs.
Right. I might lean more towards Crimson on this, man. Right. I thoroughly disenjoyed this movie, even more so than the early ones, because it felt like they tried harder on this one. And it's kind of like those Chinese finger traps or the handcuffs or whatever they call them. It's like the harder you pull, the tighter it gets. It felt like the harder they tried, the worse it got. They did this movie. I didn't feel like any of the Fantastic Four, any of the four characters had anything to them. So like all of the star power, all of the X factor that Michael B. Jordan has shown in a couple other movies, he just didn't have any of that in this. And it even showed, like, in his relationship with his dad in the movie. That was even bland. You're like, Luke Cage is dead. Like, and weren't these same two guys together on The Wire?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't see any chemistry, man, with that at all. Like, I wasn't getting anything from anybody in the movie. 10 minutes in, I was already asking questions like, you know, like, why is the government at school fairs looking for scientists?
That is, you know, a valid question.
I was also asking, like, if you're smart enough to build essentially a teleporter when you're in, like, fifth grade, why are you in public school? In regular school? Like, there's kids that go to college at 10, 11, 12. Like, why is this dude in middle school doing this?
Yeah, it
immediately fell apart for me, man. I didn't like, again, we talked about this in some of the other movies, like the forcing of the lines. I really didn't like, you know, it's clobbering time in this one at the end. It really aggravated me here. I know I'm skipping all around, but there's a lot of shit I didn't like. I didn't like when he went out to the planet. And the first time they go out, when everything goes wrong, like, they stick the flag in the ground and the ground immediately starts emitting green and they decide, yo, let's explore further. What kind of shit is that? Yeah.
They didn't use a black people census, huh? Exactly. They had a black person.
Exactly.
Like, yeah, that's the point where you're going, nah.
Oh, man. Yeah. But I gave the movie ultimately a D+ in the end.
All right.
I gave it a D+.
Okay.
All right. Not too bad. Not too bad. All right. All right. Well, that brings us to Hannibal.
It's your turn. Yeah. It's funny because I got a lot of notes that I wrote about this movie that I definitely want to talk about because there's some stuff in this movie that is not good. And Ace talked about a lot of it. Crimson talked about a lot of it. But I'm gonna take a different angle with this movie. When people grade this movie, when people review this movie, when people watch this movie, I'm not necessarily talking about Crimson and Ace here, right? I'm just in the general conversations I've had with comic book enthusiasts that are watching these movies. What I tend to find is this movie gets shat on a lot, not because it's not good or because it's bad, but because when the first Fantastic Four movies came out, there was a certain standard for what comic book movies were. That was the Daredevil time. That was the Ghost Rider time. That was the Tobey Maguire Spider-Mans, you know. And then now this Fantastic Four movie that we're talking about now came out in the middle of Phase 2 of the MCU universe. This came out after Avengers. This came out after the Dark Knight franchise. This came out after Guardians of the Galaxy. So we tend to rate this movie harder as it relates to those MCU movies, and we don't rate the other Fantastic Four movies or movies that came out before that the same way. Now, that's not fair, right? I'm trying to grade this movie for what it is as a movie. This movie is not as bad as everybody tries to make it out to be. Is it a good movie? No, it's not a good movie. It is not a good movie. And Ace Wonder and Crimson hit on a lot of the things about this movie that aren't good. Like, you know, the idea that, like, you know, why was Franklin Storm at a science fair, a high school science fair, you know, and then if Reed Richards is that smart, there's no reason he should have still been in public school. Why did they go to the planet and it was like, oh, here's some glowing green goo, because I'm going to go put my arm in it. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, and even the scene where they get their powers is one of the dumbest ways that we've seen people get powers. But then after that scene, where they show him the lab is destroyed, and you see Fantastic crawling towards Ben Grimm, and he's covered in the rocks, and Johnny Storm is on fucking fire. It's like, that's a good fucking scene. The scene before it is terrible, and then that scene is fine.
It has some great body horror in it. It does.
It absolutely has some great body horror. Like, this movie is not as bad as everybody makes it out to be. I have seen bad. I have seen Steel. I have seen Spawn. I have seen Catwoman. And this movie is not as bad as those other Fantastic Four movies. And I will challenge anybody on this with the motherfucking Bachelorette, the Bachelor dance scene in the last movie. All right? This movie is not as bad. This movie is not that bad. It is not good, but it is not bad. I gave it a C-.
I will give you this, Hannibal. They never call themselves the Fantastic Four.
No.
So if you actually say that this is not really a Fantastic Four movie, this is a Reed Richards, Thing, Human Torch, and Sue Storm movie, you are absolutely right. But this is a better movie.
I don't think you have to, like, so I don't believe, especially
hang on,
because...
Look, wait, before you take that, because I see where you're going. I see where you're going. Let me take it, and because I'm about to go where I think you're going. If it's not, then... You know, jump in, but go ahead and start my time. But before I get to where that was going, I'm going to say, to add on to what Hannibal was saying, not only have we seen Spawn, Catwoman, Steel, all 20 fucking three Tyler Perry movies, we have a pretty good fucking idea of what a bad movie is. This is not a good movie. But it's nowhere near the level of those. So that's first on this. And when you compare this, the story, like, and as I said earlier, when you separate any of these movies from the source material, like the source material is what inspired these movies. That's where we're getting our title from. And we're judging these movies as what we see on the screen. This is it. Forget everything else. This is our experience. This is our first time seeing these characters. This is our first experience with it. Take all the fanboy out of it. This movie's not great. This movie's not bad. This movie is, however, better than the first two. All day, every day. Hands down, I challenge anybody to say different. That being said, I gave Fantastic Four number one an F minus. I gave Rise of the Silver Surfer a D. I gave this a D plus. It's not that far above, but it is better.
Yeah.
It is a better movie. I watch this as this is the creature from another world coming through type sci-fi show, which is better than both of those fucking Fantastic Four movies. This is the movie that comes on at 2 a.m. that you just watch. It's, you leave it on.
That movie.
Yeah,
you know, it's,
that's
it's,
what
it's,
this
it's
is.
Reeks of mediocrity. It's forgettable.
Yeah, and I'm glad, because Ace Wonder, you just made the point that I was going to get to is... This movie isn't bad so much as it is mediocre. Like, the performances, I think the guy who played, I think his name is Reg Cathy, the guy who played Franklin Storm, I thought he did great as Franklin, I enjoyed him in this movie. Everybody else that's in the movie, their performance is flat. It is neither good nor is it terrible. It is forgettable. Yeah. Like, before we rewatched this movie, nobody remembered nothing about this movie. You rewatched it and was like, oh yeah, this stuff did happen. And a week from, and like a month from now, none of us are going to remember that we watched this movie again. But you know
what you
will remember? That fucking stupid-ass bachelor dance scene. Okay?
But you know what?
I watched it earlier today, and I had a hard time remembering it to talk about it.
But you know what? Here's the thing, and this is why I graded it. I graded it on the fucking character interactions. If they look like they have no chemistry, it can be the best motherfucking story in the world. Yeah. But if these people don't look like they will be around each other, that kills a story. The original Iron Man movie. The original Iron Man movie that Robbie Downey, he sold that fucking movie because it was his character. It was how he treated people before he was hurt. How he treated people after he was hurt. That would sold the movie. The story was shit. And if I don't know which one came out first. Did Suicide Squad come out or did this movie come out first?
I think this was first.
So how is it that Suicide Squad did a better monster from a different world with a big destroying world-ending machine turn out better than a fucking Marvel movie?
Oh, yeah. Because one, because Fox fucks shit up on a regular basis, and two, the script got like completely slashed. Like the studio all the way fucked this up, and I've never been one of those people that's been very pro the idea of Fox selling their properties over to Disney, because Fox has been at least willing to take some chances that Disney wouldn't take. Disney would have never made Logan. Disney would have never made Deadpool. Disney would have never made Days of Future Past, right? Those are movies that would not come out, you know, in the MCU. You know, and even with the New Mutants movie that I've heard that the test audiences think is amazing, they made a superhero horror film, and it's supposed to be awesome. I don't know if we'll ever see it, you know, but those are risks that you don't get under the MCU banner. Kevin Feige is not taking those chances. You know, and look, what Marvel is doing, right, what Disney Marvel is doing is absolutely working. But, like, I think if you break down the pieces of what make a movie, and you just take it piece for piece, everything in this movie at best is mediocre. Yeah, like mediocre. Like there's definitely some bad writing in here. I mean, there's definitely some bad plot points in here. But it's not as poorly written as
that first Fantastic Four.
Yeah, no, yeah. But the bad plot points in this aren't as bad as those plot points are.
Right.
So what you could arguably give it in character interaction, like everything else is like, even like the scene, like one of my favorite scenes in this movie is when Reed Richards is in Mexico trying to get the pieces he needs to buy so he can try to make another one of these machines, right? And the government swoops down on him so that they can try to capture him, and then he has to try to fight. You know, he has to fight them and flee at the same time. That was the only time. Like, I've always thought the idea of Mr. Fantastic in these movies would be terrible, because in my head, I imagine the CGI being what it looked like in the first Fantastic Four movies. That scene where he's escaping, that shit didn't look bad. It looked a guy with powers using his powers to escape, and it didn't look bad. Like him crawling through the vents and all that shit looked creepy as hell. But like the scene of him fighting to get away from everybody, that shit looked fine.
No, and I would give you that. It actually looked as if that's Mr. Fantastic when you see him fighting. And that's where I'm torn on these movies. It's like you have the original two where they actually had some chemistry, but a shit story. But you had this motherfucker wears no chemistry.
Yeah,
and
I won't, like a basic story. I won't disagree with you on. I won't fight with you on that. I definitely won't fight with you on it at all. But like when I think of movies that we've seen that are some terrible movies, just like Monty said, we watched in February our torture episode was we watched all 23 Tyler Perry movies, and of the 23 movies we watched, the vast majority of them got F's and F's minuses. Those are awful, awful, awful films. This movie is not as bad as Medea.
Hang on. While you're in there, I feel I should read this Streamlabs that came from Hoosier Atheist.
Yeah.
What kind of shithead would make you guys watch all of those Tyler Perry movies? There you go.
Hey, nobody talks about The Family That Prays, because that was a good-ass movie.
No, it's not a good-ass movie. It's a terrible movie. No. It's a terrible, terrible... No. Don't give me...
It's only for that one scene.
Which one scene? Please enlighten me on... I wish we had the versus screen right now. Which scene? Right.
Hold on. Please. The scene when they in the diner. You took my money. It's not even your money. It's that from my man.
That scene is terrible. That scene is terrible, and everybody who likes it is terrible. That shit is awful, bro.
Listen. That's the problem with Tyler Perry movies. They just, Crimson, what they did was they wowed you by showing you some wild niggardry, which we all like to see. That's why we like Worldstar so much. That was just well-produced niggardry.
Now, in that scene of that movie, that was the only... No, I'm sorry. The boardroom scene was the best scene in that movie.
So that movie's all... That scene is even worse. That's a worse scene.
That's some cutthroat shit. As much as I hate fucking capitalism, that's some cutthroat shit. Right.
Okay, you know what? We might have to have Crimson back on. Look, to a debate G-Man style, we're going to debate The Family That Prays on the shit show. We'll have to make that a thing.
I would like to not be on that show.
That shit is, look, that boardroom scene. Y'all in the chat. You mean the scene where they surprise everybody that the homeless man that's been hanging around was also a member of the board? He was just voluntarily choosing to be homeless, or the fact that Taraji P. Henson's family has been struggling with money the entire movie, just to come to find out her mama's a fucking millionaire the whole time, and the only reason she never told her daughter was because, quote unquote, well, you never asked me. Get the whole fuck out of it. That shit is awful, bro. Do not let that shit... Listen. All right, look. Tyler Perry has made so many bad movies that when he showed one that was less than bad, people said it was good. It is not a good movie. It is not a good movie at all. Like, I challenge you to rewatch that motherfucking movie. That movie is bad. That movie is like... fucking, if AIDS and syphilis got together and made a super baby, it would be the family that fucking prayed.
So this is about to piss you off too. I actually like the Miss Alex Cross.
That didn't bother me at all. And like, Tyler Perry is fine in movies that he doesn't write.
That he don't make.
Yeah. He's not the funny thing is, he's not a bad actor, and I think he might even have, well, I think Tyler Perry makes bad movies on purpose because his audience likes bad movies.
I would agree with that.
Yeah, I told somebody this about the Fantastic Four. I mean, the Fast and the Furious movies the other day. It's like, the only people I know that like the Fast and the Furious movies, the Fast and the Furious series, are people that are car enthusiasts or people that love bad movies. And incidentally, all car enthusiasts that I meet also like bad movies
and stupid explosions.
Yeah, it just, you know, bro, that movie is just, because everybody told me years that The Family That Prays was the one good Tyler Perry movie, and I was like, no, you're wrong. Okay. This movie is awful. Like, I have had so many arguments with black women about this shit, bro. Listen, I'm the motherfucking Tyler Perry slayer, okay? I think of his movies, that's one of the better ones. But it's still like a D plus at best.
A lot of his movies are just tragedy porn.
Yeah,
they are. They give you that. They are just tragedy porn, especially Four Color Girls. It's like, dude, like, really?
Really? Yeah, that's a black horror movie. That's a black woman horror movie right there. That movie is terrible.
I still stand by, and this isn't saying it's good, but I think the best movie that Tyler Perry has ever made is Good Deeds.
Yeah, I agree. Good Deeds. Good Deeds is the best movie he made.
Isn't that just the basic millionaire who runs it? It's a Cinderella story, basically.
The reason that movie isn't as bad as all his other movies is that the source material came from something familiar.
Yeah,
that says a lot. That says a whole lot. So something that he lifted the source material on was better than everything that he created from scratch. And the worst thing is, the movies that get panned by the critics the most are the Madea movies, and the Madea movies are the ones that make him the most money. Every time he makes a movie that doesn't have Madea in it, Family That Prays didn't make a lot of money.
But didn't he get a spinoff?
No. I mean, if it might have got a TV show, but it didn't get
enough movies. Yeah, TV show spinoff.
I don't listen. Doing Tyler Perry TV shows is a whole other thing. Look, this challenge, I fussed with so many black women about this shit, and these motherfuckers were like, look, if you like, and I tell people all the time, if you like the movie, say you like the movie. You know what I'm saying? But don't say it's not good just because you like it. I love 1998's Godzilla starring Matthew Broderick. That is a shit movie, though. Howard the Duck, I love that movie, but it is not a good movie. Independence Day is not a good movie, all right? I love it, but it's not good. The Family That Prays is not good. It is not a good movie. You can call it a lot of things, but you can't call it a good movie. That shit is awful. And the two worst scenes in that movie is the diner scene and the boardroom scene. You know what I'm saying? Those two scenes, just like, the plot doesn't make any sense. Like, it's insane. It is just, those are like two scenes that are so bad that you have to take those scenes and throw them in the trash. You have to drop the movie a whole letter grade based on those scenes.
Yeah. I would admit it's to that whole thing that we, so the Motion Picture Association made a standards that evil always get punished in the end.
Mm-hmm.
And that follows that standard of, oh, the bad guy's lost in the end. It does.
Yeah.
And that's what makes it emotionally satisfying.
Yeah.
It makes it emotionally satisfying.
Yeah.
And that's what makes those scenes good, because they're like terrible reason why they resolved, but it's emotionally satisifying.
Yeah. And
Sparkling Tyler Perry, little Jesus.
Yeah. Tyler Perry has gotten very good at, like, he knows that his crowd, he knows who his demographic is, he knows what their belief system is, and he knows how to pander to that shit. Like, in the movie that Hoosier Atheist made us go see, because it was him specifically that made us go see this. We had, because we made our stream goal that month, we had to go see Madea's Family Funeral. And at the end of that movie, you got the mother who's been cheated on by her husband. And she was like, yeah, I know he was cheating on me, but I stayed with him because that was what I had to do to keep my family together. And everybody in the theater was like, that's right, girl. You got to do what you got to do to keep your family together, girl. But then, you know, her, like, the mother who was getting cheated on, her son is cheating on his wife. And then Madea tells that wife, you don't need to stay with him. You too fine to be cheated on. And everybody was like, that's right, girl. You need to stay with him, girl. He ain't shit, girl. You can do better than him. So wait a minute. You literally just told one set of women it's okay to stay in a relationship when you cheated on because it's what's best for your family. But then you just told another set of women that it's okay to leave when you're getting cheated on. He just told all the women what they wanted to hear, and nobody called him out on his bullshit.
Yep.
You know why I fucking hate Tyler Perry movies? Because there are no positive black relationships in his movies. This dude runs and controls the big... This just became a Wasim Hannibal. This dude controls and operates the biggest black film studio on the planet. Where are the positive black relationships in his movies? All he does is reinforce all the negative stereotypes about black people, and we just keep giving him fucking money.
Yep. Nope. Give that money to us, Hannibal and Monty.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, and I'm like, people be like, well, you got to support him because he's black. Well, go support Spike Lee. Go support fucking the Hughes brothers. Go support, there's so many talented black filmmakers. You don't have to support Tyler Perry just because he's black. Look, that nigga's black and from New Orleans. So when I don't support him, you know it's coming from my heart, okay?
Yep.
And you know what? And that's, I'm glad you said that, because quite literally, it makes it look like we're a fucking monolith.
Yeah.
Oh, if you're black, you're going to support this. Yeah. That shit pisses me off.
Yep.
Yeah, man.
So,
this is
like the topping on a torture episode, having to talk about Tyler Perry like
this. Yeah, I know. That's why I'm about to top this shit off. Look, we brought it all the way around. We watched these fucking movies, and then we talked about Tyler Perry.
Like so, Crimson, if you want, I'll rewatch The Family That Prays. You rewatch it, and then we can do an episode. We can do a pop up episode whenever you free with me and you. Just get on here and talk about it. You know what I'm saying? Maybe I'm wrong because I only seen the movie one time. So maybe
there you
if
go.
I see it again, I might feel differently about it. If you want, you are welcome to come back and we can do that.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll get y'all in touch so that y'all can be in communication too.
Yeah, I'm going to email you my number right now, man, so you can hit me up whenever.
There you go. Put it in the chat. Yeah. So, that being said, we hit the end of a shit show. I want to, I'll go around and look, we've already said our shit at the beginning. We'll go Crimson. Like, we'll keep going in the same circle. Crimson, tell the shitheads where they can find you and what you do.
All right. So, I'm a fucking creative person. I draw, I do YouTube videos. And I'm creative with fucking gameplay. You can find me on YouTube and on Twitch at Crimson60620. You can find me on my DeviantArt page at Crimson60620. My Etsy page at Lone Sage Art. My Facebook page for my art at Lone Sage Art. And my Facebook gaming, Crimson60620 PS4 Gaming. And Twitter and Instagram. Yeah.
There we go. Ace Wonder. You got anything for the shitheads?
I never really thought about telling people who I was before. So, you know, I'm a musician. I'm also a musician. And I might possibly be the best musician that's ever walked the face of the earth outside of the guy that's probably in the square. I think he's above me right now.
There you go. There you go.
So, and if you wonder where you can find me, you can find me anywhere you can find him. That's usually everything at Team MFN.
Yep.
Yes.
That's why for the past, how long have we been friends? And why I've been friends with you longer.
2004.
It's got to be right before Katrina.
Yeah.
Yeah,
right
before 2004, Katrina. 2005. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Ever since then, these are the only people I go to when I need anything music. So. That's right.
And Monty's the only person I go to when I need arts and graphic. However, though, we got Crimson 60620.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So we definitely need to show. And look, and before this episode is over with, after when it goes, you know, so you guys can just watch it on YouTube, all of his links will be below in the comments, in the description. So please make sure you go like and subscribe and check out everything that Crimson 60620 is doing.
Yes.
So. That,
hey, Monty,
that being
said, before you get going, man, I think I'm ready to be a comic book character, man.
Oh, I can make that happen. I can make that happen.
What do we have to do to make that happen, man?
Just let me know what it is.
I could be like the light skinned Luke Cage or something, man.
I don't need to get the haircut. I kind of want a comic just called the light skinned Luke Cage.
Hey, time out. I can't do that because y'all gonna have me doing a bunch of light skinned shit, and I don't get down.
See, I would offer to draw comics, but like I like drawing anime titties too much, so I draw mostly women.
So look, listen. I don't see any reason why those things have to conflict. Okay, I think we can find.
Oh, hell no. Not on me.
Who your love interest though? You know.
Oh, yeah. All right, I'm with it.
Yes. So I gotta talk to you anyway. Ace Wonder, like from what we talked about on the last show. So we'll have to be in touch soon. We'll make it happen. But with that being said, do we have anything else we need to say before we close out, Hannibal?
No, man, I ain't got no more talking.
All right. Well, I think that's it for me. Why don't you take us to that closing screen, Zoe? Let's see if it works this time.
This was a shit show.
Y'all finished or y'all done? I ain't got no more talking.
We Halloween in Collard Greens.